Good morning and welcome to the 20th meeting of 2023 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is a declaration of interest. Before I invite our new member, Evelyn Tweed, to do that, I'd like to take the opportunity to thank Ash Regan for her contribution to this committee. And now I'd like to welcome Evelyn and ask her to declare any relevant interest.
Thanks, Convener. I have nothing to declare.
Thank you. I understand Maggie Chapman wishes to declare an interest before we start the meeting.
Thanks very much, Claire. As last week, I am a member, I'm a board member of NESCAN Hub, and I'm also a delegate to the Aberdeen Trades Union Council.
Thank you. So our next item of business is the second evidence session of this part of our Just Transition work, looking at a just transition for the North East and Moray. For context to this inquiry, the Scottish Government's target is for net zero emissions for all greenhouse gases by 2045. And Moray in the North East will play a significant role in this, and the committee recognises the challenges it faces. And that's why we're looking at action, what is action is required to support, incentivise and de-risk this transition in ways that will benefit businesses and the community. So today's evidence session comprises of two panels, and I welcome first this morning John Boland, Regional Officer, Unite, Emma Harrick, Head of Energy Transition and Supply Chain with Scottish Renewables, Mia McCarthy, Head of Sustainability, the SSE Group, and Maggie McGinley, Chief Executive of ETZ Limited. Members and witnesses are asked to keep questions and answers as concise as possible, so we have as much time to cover the areas. Could I start by maybe asking the panel members to reflect on what their understanding of a just transition for Moray in the North East is? One of the areas the committee is looking at in the inquiry is definitions, and is there a shared understanding of what is being worked to achieve here? If I maybe come to Emma first, if you would like to address that question.
Morning. Thanks for the invitation to attend this morning. I think a view on what a just transition means is, you know, renewable energy is at the heart of the energy transition, and people are at the heart of a just transition. And making sure that that move from oil and gas into renewables is having the most positive impact on the Scottish economy it can, and that impacting people and supply chain businesses in Scotland, and making sure we maximise economic benefits for them, and also looking at, you know, the number of jobs, the green jobs that are created as part of the transition, and the number of workers that have moved from oil and gas roles into renewables roles, but not just oil and gas roles, but other roles as well. So all about the jobs created and that economic benefit that comes from the transition.
And do you think, because one of the areas we're looking at is how will we know if a just transition's been delivered or not? Do you think there should be targets or, you know, marks that are identified? You mentioned jobs. Should there be a target around green jobs?
Yeah, so I think, you know, as a trade body for renewable energy, we recognise that we sort of need more robust data within green jobs. And looking at some statistics and things that Scottish Renewables has already researched and covered, we did a survey of oil and gas professionals' view on the transition, and 77% of respondents were positive about retraining to join the renewable energy sector, and 86% of those would welcome more support to join the renewable energy sector. So I think statistics around, you know, the movement of oil and gas workers into renewables is important. The other side of things is on academic training and understanding, you know, what students are studying in renewable energy related courses and the change in courses across Scotland. So some research that Scottish Renewables covered in the academic space was around looking at who is studying renewables courses, and we found that around 22,000 people are studying renewable energy related courses across Scotland. That's up 70% in the past 3 years from the same data taken 3 years ago, and it showcases, you know, 33 colleges and universities across Scotland are delivering courses that include renewable energy elements to them. And it shows a huge ambition and appetite from students to learn more about net zero and to train up and upskill for renewables. So I think data and statistics on, you know, the movement of workers into the sector, data and statistics on academic training, looking at, again, as I said, green jobs, and also statistics on those individuals and the data around those individuals. So around, you know, the diversity information, age profiles, what skill set they are moving into and what levels. So around all of those areas in terms of the targets.
We'll come back to issues of skills and the numbers and progress in the area, but maybe come to Mia and come back to the question of just transition, and if you think there's a shared understanding of what it means and how will we know if it's been delivered or not.
Good morning and thanks for inviting SSE here. I suppose just to give a tiny little bit of background, SSE is a FTSE 100 company and we're headquartered in Perth in Scotland, and we have a workforce of over 10,000 employees. So we're a leading generator of renewable energy and one of the largest electricity networks in the UK as well. And we're also an accredited real living wage employer and a fair tax mark company. And in November 2020, SSE became the first company globally to publish a just transition strategy. It was a framework of 20 principles that are outlined in the strategy, and it's to help guide our decision making and influence greater fairness for those impacted by the decline of high carbon activity and increase the opportunities for climate action. We followed this up then in September 2021 with a workers' report, a report kind of stating our principles to action, and that focused on workers in particular. And we set out 20 commitments from SSE, 10 recommendations for industry and 10 recommendations for government to support people transitioning from high carbon to low carbon jobs. And in the next decade and beyond, SSE's remaining high carbon activities will either come to an end of their natural life or they'll be repurposed to a net zero world. And to achieve this, we plan to invest $40 billion over the next 10 years. So to give a sense of the scale that's required, just in Scotland and very much in the North East and Moray region, we're looking at potentially $17 billion in transmission networks over the next 7 years. The ScotWind projects, which will amount to about $24 billion. And then you're looking at onshore wind distribution networks, carbon capture and storage, where figures are yet to be known around hydrogen. I suppose it's just kind of a sense of what it is we're kind of looking at when we're talking
and
about this.
Do you think, I suppose, the question around what a just transition is, so that's what you as a company have done. Do you think there should be more expectation on other organisations to take that kind of approach? You've kind of described yourselves as being at the lead in this area, but that seems to have been a choice that's been made by SSE. Do you think there's enough support or encouragement or obligation on other companies to understand the importance of just transition and think about how they're going to deliver that themselves?
I think there needs to be supports, given that we were the first company globally to publish our just transition strategy. We are ahead of the curve, as it were, but other companies are definitely recognising that there is that need to transition. And I think in terms of how that's done, it's in kind of a co-creation space. So in terms of government support, whether it's working with kind of civil society organisations as well as companies coming together. So I think for us, in all the work that we've done, the collaboration piece and the co-creation piece has allowed us to get to the point where we are. So bringing in unions, bringing in the employees, bringing in the communities, that by yourself in isolation, this can't be completed because all of the stakeholders need to be involved in the discussions. And just in terms of, you were asking there around the question of how do you measure whether a transition has been just, I suppose some of the points we would look at that we would think, you know, we need to kind of gather the data on would be around security of supply, access to affordability of energy and access to energy, the numbers of workers that have transitioned and have been supported to transition from high carbon to low carbon jobs, as well as the economic contribution to the supply chain and scale of community ownership of renewable energy and community benefits. So if we're kind of able to maybe pick some of those markers and look at them, as we go through this transition, we'll be able to see whether, for example, are people being left behind in this energy transition.
And John, if I come to you, if you want to address the question of what the definition of a just transition is and whether you think that's a shared understanding.
Our position as a union is obviously related to the actual workers that are going to be affected by this and the actual communities that they live in as well, and the impact that it could be on that. I mean, a measure for a just transition would be that there was good, well-paid jobs for all the workers that actually required them, and that the local communities that they lived in weren't devastated, as we've seen happened in other transitions previously. We see that there's a number of barriers to that actually happening at the moment, and we're not seeing a lot of movement on these barriers to actually stop that. We hear lots of numbers, but the actual reality of jobs and people transitioning from oil and gas into renewables is much lower.
Mm-hmm. And do you think there's enough, because you mentioned communities, is there enough effort to resolve? Do you think there's tensions within there that, you know, how is there, if we do something this way, it will benefit this group of people, but this group of people might not benefit so much? And how do we resolve those tensions? Do you think there's enough? That's what I'm talking about, like a shared understanding of what a just transition is.
Yeah, there is tensions. I mean, we have tensions within our own unions regarding actually a just transition and the move away from oil and gas and fossil fuels and greener economies. But our focus is on keeping people in work and ensuring that there's jobs for them. We fully support the actual move away from fossil fuels, but there needs to be actually jobs for people to move into, or you're going to have a lot of people unemployed, and then in these communities where they live, then that's going to have a large impact. We've seen impacts when there's been downturns in oil and gas previously in 2015, 2019. We saw the hotels, we saw the actual restaurants, the pubs all closing. We saw the actual impact on taxi drivers, other people that actually relied on these jobs. The difference is, this time, unless there's alternative jobs, it won't be a downturn, it will be permanent.
Thank you. Maggie, if I come to you and back to the question of just transition and definitions, and how will we know if it's been delivered or not?
Good. So thank you for the opportunity to appear. And as ET said, Limited, we're based in Aberdeen and have a remit to support work in Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire, and also through Just Transition funding, also extending to Moray as well. So it's well documented, and we're a not-for-profit, so we're all about economic development for the region. It's well documented how important oil and gas has been and continues to be for the Scottish and UK economy, both in terms of GVA and also in terms of jobs. So the Just Transition has to be about how do we have a managed transition to deliver on net zero, and a managed transition in terms of going from oil and gas to greener, lower carbon forms of energy, and do that in a way that no one is left behind. So it is about individuals in the workforce, it is about the communities, it is about those businesses that have been involved in the oil and gas sector and who are very keen and ambitious to move into offshore wind, hydrogen, carbon capture and storage, etc., but need the support to do that. And when we talk about those businesses, the northeast of Scotland has got the largest concentration of energy supply chain companies in the UK. So we're talking about companies who are employing 10 people or employing 1,000 people or employing 5,000 people. So there's a huge range of companies in there and a real asset to Scotland and the Scottish economy. So it's how do we support those companies to continue to be successful as we're moving into cleaner, greener forms of energy. And therefore, that's all about therefore how that continues and maintains jobs, sustains jobs, creates new jobs, and also therefore supports communities. So the just transition for me has to be about how we do this in a managed way and consider individuals, communities, businesses and the overall energy sector in that.
And do you think we're clear enough around what is being measured and what success will look like? And other witnesses have spoken about data gaps. Do you think that's a challenge in trying to determine?
I think it is a challenge. I mean, as we've heard, there are lots of different things that can be measured, and I agree with all of the suggestions. It's also about how many people are going into education linked to energy, for example. I think the key thing is how do we have the right data to support that and have easy access to that data so that it can be measured easily. Some of the data is easily available, but I'd say some of it is not. And I do think we need to revisit all the SIC codes and how we're actually measuring industry sectors and therefore how we can easily measure the impact and the difference that is being made.
OK, thank you. I'll now come to Colin Smith to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to the panel. One of the issues that's been highlighted in the submissions we've received is the challenge of skill shortages within the energy sector. The Aberdeen Grampian Chamber of Commerce submission talked about their spring 2023 energy transition survey that said there's already challenges for businesses with regards to worker shortages. So in your experience, is there evidence already of skill shortages in the energy sector, and what specifically do you think is required from government to support you tackling those shortages? I'll start with, Emma's nodding, so I'll start with Emma. I appreciate that actually Scottish Renewables submission highlighted quite a few of where those shortages are. So where are those shortages at the moment?
So, I mean, if you look at the renewable energy industry at the moment, the industry already supports 27,000 Scottish jobs and an economic output of £5.6 billion a year. And the industry has a big impact on other areas of Scotland's economy, sort of across construction, manufacturing, and a huge variety of skill sets is required to deploy a renewable energy project. So everything from welders to lawyers, architects and even caterers. There's opportunity within renewable energy projects across the whole project life cycle, so right at your development stage, all the way through to construction, installation and even life extension and decommissioning. So there's huge skills opportunities in there. And due to decades of experience, the North East and Moray is well placed to provide skills for these activities. However, there are some key skills challenges within the sector. We kind of categorise those in three areas. So skills shortages, which is sort of finding and keeping enough people with the right skills across all disciplines. The skills gap, which is training and upskilling the people we have and what I spoke about in terms of moving oil and gas workers into the sector. And skills cannibalisation, so that's about keeping people in the sector and in Scotland. The sector is characterised by big multinational companies with mobile workforces that move around. Our members have advised to us that there are some skills gaps that exist in the renewable sector, and that includes things in the construction space like welders and technicians. But there's also skills gaps in that development stage, in the early stage. There is a shortage of planners, and it's really important that we speed up planning and consenting of renewable energy projects, and there is a shortage there. There's also skills gaps within electrical technicians and engineers, but also, you know, to work in renewables, we don't just need engineers. There's project managers and there's a shortage of logistics managers as well. And vessel crew, people working on the vessels, whether that be those doing site survey or those doing transport and installation. Looking at things that are not necessarily offshore as well across other technologies, there's a shortage in low carbon heat installers and also things like robotics engineers. So I guess where we see that challenge, there is opportunity. Offshore wind will make an essential contribution to skills in Scotland, and we have to consider the cascading benefits as well across other technologies. If we have a look at green hydrogen, the Scottish Government's green hydrogen assessment set out three scenarios for hydrogen, which delivered between 70,000 and 310,000 jobs. The Cromarty Firth has been identified as an ideal location for hydrogen, and the North of Scotland programme hydrogen programme is established as part of that. Green hydrogen, of course, is really key here when it comes to renewables, and it can offer a huge GVA to Scotland's economy, sort of in that high scenario of 310,000 jobs and £25 billion GVA. Having a look at other cascading areas as well, looking at, you know, alongside new power generation, there will also be substantial investment in the transmission network and the grid, and that will deliver high-value, high-quality, long-term jobs, and there's huge opportunity there. SSE in transmission has plans to invest £10 billion in the electricity grid in the north of Scotland, and that can support over 9,000 high-value jobs. There'll be no transition without transmission, and there's, you know, huge opportunity there within the grid space. So as much as there are skills gaps and challenges, there is huge opportunity coming from renewable energy for all these sorts of roles across Scotland.
So there's those opportunities. What actions do you think are needed from government to make sure that we have the workers to take advantage of those opportunities? You talked about speeding up the consenting process, which was one of them. That would obviously reduce the pressure on those who've got that role to drive these things forward. But what other actions would be needed from government?
So in terms of supporting the skills, a lot of people that are looking to upskill and transition into renewable energy can sometimes need to pay out of their own pocket for upskilling to move into those roles. And it is a bit of a barrier for the individuals. So establishing a just transition tuition fund to help individual workers to cover the costs of some of the fees required to get the new accreditations or for tuition to help them move into renewable energy roles would be something that would offer support there.
That's great. And I seen John nodding, so sorry.
Can I just ask Emma a question before you move on? When I looked down, thanks for the information that Scottish Renewables gave us. And when I looked down the list, in your mind, you do tend to see men fulfilling these roles. What do you think needs to be done to encourage women into these roles? You've described an expanding sector and lots of opportunities. How do you do that? And do you know if anybody is collecting the roles in terms of gender disaggregation of the workforce?
Of course, you know, the industry sees diversity as hugely important. And as part of the offshore wind sector deal, there's diversity ambitions in that. And I think one of the things that's really important is STEM activity and early engagement here. So engaging, you know, in early school years and encouraging enthusiasm for science and engineering and technology and maths, you know, across that diversity level, and encouraging, you know, young women to take up those subjects. A lot of our members are carrying out activities in that space already. Ocean Winds, who's the developer of the Moray East and Moray West project, has launched a STEM programme and is working with schools in Fraserburgh, Buckey and in Edinburgh. And they have STEM ambassadors that go into local schools and encourage enthusiasm for those same STEM subjects, but also raise an awareness of the skills that are required to deliver renewable energy so that young people know what roles are, you know, there for them as an opportunity to go into it. And that does have a focus on diversity as well and making sure young women are interested in those roles.
OK, thank you, Mr Smith.
Thanks very much, Convener. I'll come to John again, because you're nodding there, John, about the challenges of skill shortage. This is obviously an issue facing your members, how we make sure that they have the skills to presumably take advantage of the opportunities Emma talks about.
Yeah, I mean, there's no doubt there's a skill shortage. I mean, there's a skill shortage across the whole of the UK in actually trained people and experienced actual people, and some of that's maybe down to a lack of apprenticeships and that have come through over the years. The difficulty that we see is the actual people transitioning from, like, oil and gas into renewables because of the barriers that are there. And Emma touched on one of the barriers there, which is like round about your actual certification and your competencies and that alignment between the different sectors, between like oil and gas and wind. Some work's been done on that with the skills passport, but that is still uncertain as it stands at the moment. But there's other barriers. Big barrier is pay and terms and conditions between offshore oil and gas and actual offshore wind. You would be speaking probably in the range of about 20,000 difference for an electrical technician offshore in oil and gas and the same role on offshore wind. Another barrier is the jobs. The jobs in actual renewables are not there in the quantity or numbers that are going to be required. And by the time that number ramps up, there will be a downturn in actual oil and gas, and a lot of the skills that are there will be lost to other sectors as well. So these are actually the main barriers that we see for people actually transitioning. It is good to actually go into the schools and advertise actual renewables and get people interested, but that's a long-term goal, because there's a lot of time there, a time gap for people to actually go through school, get the training and actually come into that industry. And it's the big problem, as we see, is going to be the period between now and probably 2030, where there is going to be a downturn in oil and gas. There will be less jobs there, but there isn't going to be the level of actual growth in renewables to support these jobs that are getting lost.
Is there any actions that you feel that government could take during that period to make sure your members could benefit from those opportunities?
Yeah, there's several actions I think the government could take. I mean, one of the main actions we think is actually supporting investment in manufacturing within actually, particularly within actually offshore wind. There is the opportunity for that. A lot of that at the moment is done abroad, and if you look at the actual estimates on numbers for example, in offshore wind, being estimated at about 50,000, when you take out the actual manufacturing and construction element of that, it drops significantly. Again, that's an area where support for actually having a manufacturing base so that some of that actual work could be done in Scotland would be great. You've got actually sites like Bifab or NIG that actually could be developed and actually doing that, particularly for the floating actual platforms. Another ask of government would be to support removing these barriers that are raised previously to allow oil and gas workers to transition into renewables. As I say, some work's been done with the Skills Passport. It's in a difficult phase at the moment. The terms and conditions, there's no union recognition, there's no collective agreements actually for offshore wind. We've got collective agreements for offshore oil and gas that could easily be transferable into offshore wind or into hydrogen or CCS. The agreements that we've done for oil and gas just a couple of years ago were left to be that flexible, that could be actually done as well. And as I say, the main thing is that jobs, but then again, that comes back to the way to get jobs at the moment is to capitalise as much as possible on basically offshore wind, because that's the main renewable at the moment. It will come into hydrogen and CCS, but offshore wind is the main one that could produce the jobs at the moment when it's needed.
Oh, that's very helpful, John. Thanks very much. And coming to Mia and Maggie, Mia, I mean, are you already facing skill shortages at SSE at the moment, and what do you think the government should be doing to support you tackling them?
Yeah, I suppose it's kind of repeating a lot of what Emma and John have already said, but around the urgent skills mapping piece to see and identify where exactly roles are needed and what are the skills that are needed within those roles. Being able to provide, say, green energy training academies, so very concerted and direct focus, high quality conversion programs, so as John's just said there, in terms of making it easier for people to be able to transition over from high carbon to low carbon, funding universities and colleges, so in terms of, you know, what are the courses at the moment that are being offered to students, and in 2, 3, 4 years time when they graduate, will they be fit for purpose in terms of what the industry is looking at or needing. Again, STEM has been mentioned, very important in terms of kind of that early years intervention, in terms of being able to provide the education and knowledge and the interest in the various topics that will be again needed, and that kind of gets to the heart of the diversity piece in terms of encouraging more young girls at an earlier age to become interested in certain topics. And then I suppose in terms of kind of apprentice schemes and funding schemes, being able to have more flexibility around the delivery of those. And we recognise that there is the skills shortage in terms of what we've kind of set out is that we need 1,000 new roles a year to be able to kind of service the scale of what we're looking at doing in terms of our operations. One of the recent reports from the Robin Gordon focused on the northeast of Scotland and identified that there was 45,000 employees there in the energy sector, 40,000 of those which were in oil and gas, and it also identified that out of that 90% have the skills that would be very easily transferable to a low carbon industry. So it's being able to, I suppose, ensure that those people are facilitated in making that transition. Just from our own terms, back in 2021 we started surveying our employees and we put in questions particularly around the just transition and asking them had they transitioned over the last 2 years from high carbon industry into SSE, and we've continued to do those questionings and those surveys up until now, and we now do them on a 6-monthly basis. And so the most recent findings from that would say that 1 in 4 workers now that come to SSE have transitioned from high carbon industry, so that's about 28% of our workforce. And interestingly enough as well, about the same proportion of men and women have transitioned, so about 30% on each side. So that would say, I suppose, that would maybe give a slight argument to the idea that there isn't that diversity in terms of those transitioning. And also, interestingly enough, now in terms of our renewable side of the business, 40% of the workforce are now made up of people who have transitioned over. And when we've kind of drilled down, as we've gone along, we've asked more detailed questions to really try and identify kind of what the environment or the landscape is out there. And interestingly enough, in terms of the pay piece, the reward piece, that was always something where it was said that it's a barrier to, for people to transition in terms of, you know, maybe the pay scales not being quite what they would be in the oil and gas industry. But the most recent responses have shown that actually of those who've transitioned, the numbers that answer the questions would say that they're more satisfied than the general population of SSE's workforce with reward and also with leadership and other kind of indicators that we've asked for. But that was something that came out to us just recently, and we were surprised by that because we thought in some instances that that may be kind of the barrier for people. And then there's other things around, say, flexibility and kind of work-life balance and things like that. But that data would show us that there's a steady flow of people coming through, and as we move along and continue to survey people and continue to think of other questions that we can ask, it'll kind of throw up, I suppose, more information for us. But going back to the point, there is the skills gap, and I suppose in terms of, you know, what we're doing as a company, things are on a smaller scale. So, for example, identifying mechanics and them retraining within our distribution side of the business for kind of electrician roles. But all of that is on small scale. When we're talking about 1,000 employees a year, you know, you may have a cohort of 20 people. So it's being able to put in place, I suppose, a more robust framework and something that can cope with the larger numbers that that will need to be transitioning over time in order for us to be able to access the opportunities that the low carbon sector presents.
And do you think that the current skills development landscape is set up to enable you to deliver that? Are there changes that are required there that would enable that to happen?
I think those changes that I mentioned before would facilitate probably a faster transition, because as we see at the moment from our the data that's coming back, people are coming and they are transitioning, and the skills that they have are skills that are easily transferable because they're coming to roles and they're taking up the roles, you know, in without any issues. But there is definitely areas we're actually undergoing a piece of research at the moment, which is more, I suppose, the long-term kind of planning piece around kind of over the next 5 years, 10 years, what are the sunrise industries, what are the sunset industries, you know, so those that will be burgeoning and those that will be going into decline, and being able to really, I suppose, have a targeted look at what that landscape looks like, and within that then what are the skills that people have within those roles. Because we know in terms of, say, any of our operations, if we take offshore for example, the roles across the whole operation, you know, you're going from an environmental specialist on one end to legal, financial on the other, and everything in between. Like, all of those people will be needed to ensure that these operations get up off the ground and then actually run after that. So it's a wide range of skills that will be required. Sometimes people, again, kind of maybe look at it in a more narrow view and kind of say engineering or, you know, very specific roles, but roles across so many different parts of the operations will be needed over time.
I'm tempted to ask you, Maggie, if there's any areas that you think there's not a skill shortage in at the moment within the sector, but you'll obviously speak to the businesses all the time that you're working with. I mean, are these skill shortages issues something that's familiar to you? And again, what actions do you believe the government needs to take to support that challenge?
So short answer is yes. So I won't repeat what my colleagues have said. I think in terms of what action can be taken, I mean, we've heard about the sort of the transferability of skills. So often the skills are the same, they're just deployed in a different way, whether they're coming from oil and gas into offshore wind or other sectors. So that's a really important point. And we've also heard about there's a risk that the offshore renewable projects are not yet at a scale, and therefore we need to continue with oil and gas projects so that there's not this massive gap that's going to create lots of lost jobs. So one of the challenges is about attracting young people into the sector, and I think therefore the rhetoric around the importance in oil and gas and how important oil and gas continues to need to be for the economy as we build up the scale of offshore renewables, I think, is really important. And I think that's really important for government and others to give those clear messages, because the young people maybe going into an oil and gas operator who's now really an energy operator, so most of them are now going into offshore renewables, or whether they're going into a supply chain company, the reality is they may be working in oil and gas projects now because that's where most of the work is, but over time they will then develop their skills and start working on offshore wind projects or hydrogen projects, etc. So we want people to be encouraged to come into the industry get their skills maybe in oil and gas, but then they're there as we build up the capacity in offshore renewables. So the messaging and the positive messaging around this is an energy sector and we need a managed transition is really important, that that's better understood and better messaged. In terms of some of the other things, I mean, the Just Transition Fund has been really helpful in supporting the National Energy Skills Accelerator with work to put on short-term courses about upskilling and reskilling, and they've been really welcomed. So the universities, both universities locally and NESCOL, the college, have put on those short courses, and they've been a really good uptake. So continue to support in those ways is really important. The Scottish Funding Council has been supporting NESA with a Pathfinder project, and that's been helping to help people better understand the pathways that they can take, so that it's clearer that you maybe start off in this business doing this job, but actually this can then lead to opportunities as offshore renewables picks up. So those sort of pathway and pathfinder projects are really important, and doing more of those would be really helpful. We need more sustained funding of tertiary education providers so that the new courses that are needed, because there is a percentage of jobs that we don't yet know what they are, and so therefore sustained funding for tertiary education is really important so that our universities and colleges can adapt to what the needs of the industry will be, and they are evolving those needs. And then finally, the Just Transition Fund has also supported the Energy Transition Skills Hub in Aberdeen, which is within the Energy Transition Zone. It's under construction at the moment. That's predominantly funded by the Just Transition Fund and also through Scottish Government ETF Fund. That's attracted £1.8 million investment from Shell, and also NESCOL will be the operator for that. The local college will operate that. And so that's a great example where that's about providing more welding and fabrication facilities. It's going to be flexible so that whether it's hydrogen fuel cell or wind turbine technicians or whatever is needed, that the college has got the facilities and can respond quickly to that. Importantly, it's also got an outreach vehicle, so it's going to go around the secondary schools and help young people understand better what the types of jobs are that we're going to start to seeing in hydrogen and offshore wind, etc., so young kids can better understand what subjects they may want to study that will then lead to jobs in low carbon and green energy. And then finally, it's also got an outreach for community and being able to offer courses for upskilling and reskilling for people that are maybe on evenings and weekends, so that people don't have to take time out of their full-time job but can maybe do some upskilling and reskilling at other times, is, I think, a really important opportunity for people in the community, and to get funding support for that through government, I think will be really important as well.
That's really helpful.
Yeah, I'll have to make some progress. If I could ask witnesses to be as concise as possible in the questions, we do have a big panel this morning. I will allow Kevin Stewart one supplementary, but if you can direct it to one of the panel members
Very brief supplementary, convener, and it's for Mr. Boland, because he said that the Scottish passport is in a wee bit of a difficult phase. Obviously, SDS are on the panel after you. What do you think the difficulties are, Mr. Boland, and how can they be overcome quickly?
Well, quickly, the Scottish passport was meant to be in place by quarter three this year, and it's not in place at the moment. There was a reset meeting about 3 weeks ago, which I attended, with all the main actual stakeholders there. And there's still, as far as I can see, a big gap between what is looked for on the skills passport and bringing the wind industry on board. Because as it stands at the moment, the skills passport was to allow that transferability between oil and gas and actually wind primarily at the moment. But at the moment, there's no an agreement or an alignment on the survival, the actual competencies and that are actually required. So there's another meeting getting set up in January, and there's meant to be some work going on between there. But I think come January, that will tell whether the skills passport is going to be successful or not.
Maybe too many meetings and not enough action by the sounds of it.
That's what we've been saying for 5 years.
Thank you very much, Mr. Boland.
Okay, thank you. Evelyn Tweed, to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks, Convener. I think Colin's line of questioning sort of covered quite a lot of the things that I was going to ask about. But one thing I was going to ask the panel was the Aberdeen City Council has said the elements of the skills development infrastructure are in place. However, there remains a cluttered landscape, and I think that had been mentioned earlier by the panel. And they also said it's an unclear landscape on both funding and delivery. Do the panel share that view? How do you feel about this? Because from the things that we've been saying about upskilling, etc., there's various things that the panel members are saying. How can it be clearer? Would anyone like to come in? Maggie, you're smiling.
I'm not going to smile anymore. I think the importance is about the pathway. So from schools through to whether it's college and further higher education and into jobs, whether that's through apprenticeships. And then if we can get a clearer pathway, so I'm talking specifically about the energy sector, I think it then helps industry to understand where they can best do work with schools and STEM subjects, or when they can better interact with the college. And it provides a clearer route for people who are looking to, change jobs or upskill or reskill. So there's something about that pathway and having clearer about what it takes from what sort of subjects you do at school through to what opportunities that can lead you to do at college or university or through apprenticeships or jobs, and then what sort of jobs that leads you through. And if we can get those pathways clearer, I think that then helps declutter to a certain extent the landscape, because then it's clearer where everyone can play their role. There are lots of really good initiatives around STEM subjects, for example, in schools. And again, it's just are there opportunities to try and make them more efficient and consolidate them more, so that schools maybe don't have lots of opportunities coming at them when we know that teachers are really, really busy. But they can sort of try and prioritise and manage what they do. So, yeah, I think there's definitely things that can be done. But I'd also say that's a good problem to have, because I think there's a lot of private sector are doing a lot of really good stuff to try and encourage young people to understand the opportunities in the energy industry and encourage people into the sector.
I think just in terms of, as Maggie has said, there's a lot out there. Probably a part of it is the scale that everything is moving at, so we need people kind of trained and ready to go today, but there's all this wonderful work for the next generation that's coming up, so as they move through school and go to university, by the time they come out, all of that will have been in place and they'll be well prepared for whatever the workforce looks at that stage. But in terms of the role for employers or companies, I suppose there's always that thing around, we're also focusing on our internal employees and their retraining and repurposing. So within our Just Transition strategy that I've made mention of earlier, one of the focuses is on prioritising retraining and redeployment. So I suppose for companies that are out there and where they are transitioning, and whether it be around the repurposing of the assets that they had, and being able to ensure that there's kind of the access to the retraining piece, so that employees can be brought along on this change to net zero. So that would be kind of a crucial part, I suppose, of from the company perspective. As we say, there's a lot out there kind of in terms of the educational sphere and with some of the agencies as well, but maybe some of the responsibility in terms of companies when they're putting together a strategy around their just transition, to be able to ensure that that is in there, and what does that training look like. Again, with some of that, it's kind of on a small scale, and it's like, how do we kind of ensure that the momentum is there to allow this kind of to be built out?
Be quick with my answer, I guess. My view just on the sort of making it clear side of things is two things. I think it's everyone's favourite word in the sector is collaboration across Scotland and across the UK. Skills development in one area or in one technology will affect and have a knock-on effect on technologies in other areas. So, for example, we've talked about offshore wind, but there's a lot of current opportunity in onshore wind, and there's a huge pipeline of onshore wind as well. And skills development within that technology will have a knock-on effect on skills development and other technologies preparing for sort of the future pipeline. And I think, you know, there's going to be floating offshore wind projects in Scotland. Scotland has the biggest pipeline of floating offshore wind projects in the world, but there is also floating offshore wind projects in the Celtic Sea. So collaboration across the skills for floating across the whole of the UK is important. So collaboration there. And I think the other thing is a communication. I think the people on the panel live and breathe renewable energy. We can see the opportunity that is coming, but I think sometimes some people or people in Scotland maybe don't have an awareness of the skills that are required and the opportunity that is there in front of them. So I think communicating that opportunity to the people of Scotland and letting them know the opportunities that are out there is really key. So that's my two things.
I'll be even quicker. There's no clear actual path for somebody actually moving into renewables that's across the board. We've been getting asked this from members probably for the last 4 or 5 years. Because there's a lot of interest in renewables and there's a lot of potential there. But it's what that actual path is. How does somebody actually get there from A to B? And that's what's missing at the moment. And I think that's what will be missing for schools and that as well, if they're teaching actual future renewables engineers. How do you go from where you are now to get to that actual job? And it just has to be something, that path, A to B. It doesn't seem particularly hard.
Okay. If it's brief, yeah, that's
yes, John, you hit on a good point there, because what is the path, but how is it accessible as well, and who is it accessible to? So I think that's something that probably has to be looked at going forward. That's
nice. Thank you. Colin Beattie to be followed by Brian Little.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd like to touch on one or two issues around skills and so on, and expand a little bit on what's been discussed so far. I mean, there's always been an assumption that there'll be this very smooth transition from the energy sector into the renewables sector, and yet evidence that we've taken in this committee before indicate that that is not really happening at the pace that was anticipated. But it leaves us then, other industries, other sectors are needing to develop skills. For example, the construction industry for retrofit in the built environment. And just looking at that, the Construction Industry Training Board estimates that to meet net zero targets, there's a need for an additional 4,600 project managers, as well as 4,300 plumbers and HVAC workers by 2028 in Scotland. That's a lot of bodies. And looking at the other sectors within industry, they are all showing huge deficits in terms of the number of bodies that they can recruit versus the number that they need. So there's really a two-part question here. One is, the skills pipeline that's been set up to deliver these wider skills requirements across the different sectors, is it working? Is it up to the quality that's needed? And where are these workers going to come from, given the acute shortage of workers, particularly skilled workers, right across the economy? John, maybe I can ask you first on that.
It's a good question, because I can't answer where they're going to come from, because we're even seeing in oil and gas there's acute shortages within certain actual disciplines, and there's a time lag between training people up, and even if you started training people up now, they're not going to be there. I think the other thing is, there's got to be a reality between what jobs are going to be created in renewables and long-term jobs, and what jobs are actually could be lost in oil and gas. I mean, if you take an example, I was kind of looking at, you've got Seagreen, it's just came on, which has got, I think it's roughly around about 80 full-time individuals that will be there. But you compare that to a large oil platform, which could have up to 500 people full-time there. So I think the reality, as you said originally, that renewables is going to replace all the oil and gas jobs. It's not going to do that, no, in our opinion. Not unless there's additional areas looked at, like actually construction and that as well. The construction industry, and I think there needs to be more of a link-up, but where we're even finding difficulties between people moving between offshore oil and gas and offshore wind, there's difficulties between people moving between offshore oil and gas and onshore construction. Because again, there's different certifications, there's different requirements there, there's different costs for the people actually doing that as well. And it's again how you break down a lot of these actual barriers. So it's much easier if you've got an electrician offshore, an electrician can work onshore. I'm an electrician to trade, and I've worked in many different actual categories, from manufacturing to NHS to actual local authority. You can work on all these. It's just working on a different piece of equipment. But the standard bodies and that make it much more difficult to actually do that.
You spoke about electricians there, and one thing that's been at the back of my mind is how transferable actually are all the jobs that are available in the oil and gas sector and elsewhere in terms of coming into the renewables?
There's a lot of transferability. I mean, like I said, I can only go back on my own experience and actually working in that and working in different industries. You move into a different industry, you need training on the specific equipment you're working on. You don't need to retrain as in the basics, which you actually get when you do an apprenticeship or that as well. So there is a lot of similarities between, I would say, renewables and oil and gas, where there's actually trades there. There will be some upskilling that's required because of the different equipment that's there. But there is a small workforce, small skilled workforce, that is very good at what they actually do across the UK. And we've got to find better ways of actually using them across all sectors.
Emma, can I maybe turn to you?
I think I might just kind of add on to John's point there around the sort of supply chain and the businesses in the area. I mean, there's a huge wealth of expertise within, you know, the subsea environment and things like that in the North East. And many of the Offshore Wind Scotland developers have committed to supporting the education and skills to sort of fill those gaps as part of their supply chain development process and their supply chain development statements as part of the Scotland leasing round. And they've made commitments to things like engaging with the local schools, collaborating with colleges to provide apprenticeships and promoting diversity and supporting accreditation. But there's also a lot of work going on at the sort of grassroots level, the boots on the ground within the supply chain. There's companies in the North East like Ace Aquatech, who are a marine mammal protection innovator, and they're based in Dundee. And because of a result of the growth that they've seen from renewable energy, their team has gone from 5 people to 35 people, and that includes graduates and modern apprentices, and they're really keen on supporting skills development. There's also a company called Gibb Group, who are based in Aberdeen, and they're a PPE specialist. They've seen their workforce grow by over 30 people, and that growth has come from a result of the demand they're seeing from renewable energy. And they've created an apprenticeship programme to engage with local colleges and support that sort of skills gap there. It's also happening at our ports in the Port of Montrose. They carry out lots of engagement with schools in partnership with SSE, who have the SC Green O&M base at their facility. So there's lots of work going on in the supply chain and in those businesses. There's a huge amount of supply chain businesses across Scotland that have a lot of skill sets that are transferable, and many of them are pivoting already, like those companies I mentioned. And some others include Balmoral, who offer, you know, subsea protection, and they have roots from as far back as, you know, 1980s and further, and they started out in oil and gas and are now, you know, growing hugely because of renewables. So a lot of impact and the jobs that are being created is coming from the supply chain businesses themselves.
Are there physically enough bodies out there to fill these posts? I mean, when I look at the construction industry, talking about 4,600 project managers, I mean, that's a huge number to train up and have skilled by 2028. 4,300 plumbers. You try and phone for a plumber at the moment and see how quickly he comes. I mean, are there physically enough resources, human resources out there to fill all these posts that are being touted?
It's a good question. It's a tricky one that I wouldn't be able to answer in terms of the statistics and the numbers. But, you know, I can say that the industry is doing a lot to try and, you know, overcome that challenge. But in terms of numbers, it's not something I can give.
I mean, is it a case that, you know, we may have to import some of the skills if we can? because everybody's competing for them. And then there's a question of pricing around scarce skills. So, you know, for the right people, the costs could be quite substantial.
You know, I know some members that were within Scottish Renewables are finding it, you know, they are having challenges in this space, but not something I have the detail on. But some of our members are facing that as a challenge to find the right people. And that's why they're implementing these apprenticeship programmes and investing in the skills development, because they can see that this is a challenge.
May I, have you got a view on this?
Thank you. I suppose going back to your question of how transferable are these skills, if we look back again at that Robert Gordon report, the Making the Switch, that identified the 45,000 that were working in the oil and gas industry in the Northeast, and that 40,000 of them were in oil and gas, 45 in the energy sector as a whole, but recognising that 90% of their skills were transferable. And I suppose the figures that I pointed to earlier in terms of our internal surveys, it would show that people are transferring over. You know, at this moment in time, people are coming to us, and that transition is happening at a pace when you look at renewables, with 40% being from high carbon industry, and transmission similarly would see a lot of people transitioning over as well. So at this moment in time, people are coming. There isn't that barrier to them being able to transfer. But as more projects come on stream, as bigger projects are built, there will definitely be a need for more people. But I think that figure alone is quite important to show that out of that 40,000 are transferable. So if we look at the numbers in oil and gas at the moment, and you took that, you could probably say that a lot of their skills would transfer over. And in terms of, again, with the infrastructure that's being looking to build out, Emma had kindly mentioned earlier around our transmission side of the business and the $10 billion that's being invested in that. But that's looking at a potential of 9,000 jobs that will be required over the lifetime of the Pathway to 2030 projects. So there is great opportunity for jobs on mass scale over the coming years. And as you rightly say, it's to ensure that as we move forward, and which is the purpose of us all being here, is that, you know, we're prepared and that there is the pathways for people to be able to transition, because the opportunities will be there, and it's just ensuring that the speed at which they're needed will match the training of these employees, kind of to be able to transition, making that transition as easy and accessible as possible, really. And that's true the various ways that people had mentioned earlier around the skills mapping piece, the STEM, all of those combined to allow for that to happen. Otherwise, there will be those missed opportunities.
Maggie, have you got any thoughts on this?
Just a final point, the National Energy Skills Accelerator, that's a partnership between ETZ Limited, NESCOL, University of Aberdeen, RGU, and Opito and Skills Development Scotland. And that's very much been about focused about understanding what industry need is, and then ensuring that the university and colleges can then respond appropriately to industry needs. So that really strong relationship is, I think, really important to continue, so that the plumbers or electricians or whatever it is that we need, that, for example, the college can respond appropriately and quickly. That, of course, does need funding. So back to the point about, you know, our colleges, etc., do need funding to be able to train the people that the industry needs for the future. I guess the other part, just to build on what hasn't been mentioned, is where it's possible for example, high-value manufacturing, for some of the offshore, is about robotics and automation, and where there's investment through our universities and into industry about what types of roles can be more suited to automation. And, you know, there's a balance there, obviously, to be struck. But we have got some good capability around the National Manufacturing Institute for Scotland to look at where that can also play a role. So there's definitely a tight labour market, but without a doubt, and it, you know, needs quite a joined-up approach between academia, government, industry, to really work out what that plan needs to look like, so that we don't miss opportunities, as everyone has said.
Thank you.
Brian Whittle, to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you, Kavina. Good morning to the panel. I just want to kind of tease out a few of the points that have been made earlier. I think, you know, there's a sense here of, obviously, there's significant opportunities in renewable technologies for Scotland going forward. One of the and, you know, we want a green economy. We I think we're very far advanced. We're well advanced in things like onshore offshore wind. We seem to be doing particularly well in that. Maybe behind the curve a bit in other things like hydrogen, but in the practicalities of what we're talking about today in terms of just transition. You know, we've already heard that there's a mismatch or not quite matching the growth in the green economy is not matching the, you know, the decline in the oil and gas jobs, and in terms of just transition, that's where we need to be. So I think it's how do we create the sector for people to transition into, and are we supporting innovation enough to make sure we're creating that commercial success that then gives the confidence for those who want to transition to move into that? I'll start with you, Maggie, if I could.
Yep. Thank you. No, so there's a lot to be done to accelerate the opportunities in green energy and low carbon energy. So, for example, the offshore wind projects, you know, around the planning and consenting and how quickly all of that can happen. For the companies then to be able to progress the project. So there's definitely a need for a more joined up approach by Scottish Government and UK Government so that there is a plan around how we accelerate the ScotWind projects, and that, you know, that's a cohesive plan and about what actions does UK Government need to take, what action does Scottish Government need to take, what action does the industry need to take, so that we can make progress there. Because the longer these projects, you know, go out, and it's 2027, 2028, and then it's 2028, 2029, and so it goes on. So we need to do what we can to make the conditions right to accelerate the ScotWind projects. The INTOG projects that are going ahead, they're really important. They're about decarbonisation in terms of oil and gas and about floating wind. So it's really important that they're supported, and that the process to get them from the licence to actually up and running is as streamlined as possible, and that both governments and industry are working closely to do that. In terms of innovation, Lynena mentioned about floating offshore wind. That's a massive opportunity for Scotland. It's got about a third of the global pipeline for floating offshore wind are the Scottish projects. There's great capability because of our subsea oil and gas expertise built up over the last few decades. And so it's how do we provide the right environment for those floating wind projects to get the cost down and the scale up. And that's about innovation and R&D support. We've got lots of great supply chain companies who have got innovative ideas about how this can become more efficient. So have they got access to the right funding to help them progress their ideas and quickly enough? It's, you know, any energy project offshore is really costly and high risk. So there's a definite market failure there that needs government support to get behind that to reduce the risk. One of the first projects as ETZ Limited that we've done has been to work with ORE Catapult to create the National Floating Wind Innovation Centre. And that's about helping companies to do joint industry projects and collaborate so we can try and get the cost down and the scale up. So those types of projects are really important, and important that they continue to be supported either at a UK level through Innovate UK or a Scottish level through Scottish Enterprise and others.
Okay, thank you. A lot of the answers are coming. We talk about offshore wind and floating wind platforms, but we've heard, you know, and I'm a big supporter of the potential of green hydrogen to the Scottish economy. But for me, we're very far behind the curve on that, and it takes significant investment to develop a green hydrogen economy. So, Mia, from your perspective, you know, where do we need to go with that to get sort of technologies like the green hydrogen economy to catch up with where we are with wind?
I suppose in terms of kind of looking at the specific opportunities for the northeast, so if we look at Peterhead, which would be our major thermal plant, and looking to develop that out as a carbon capture power station, and that would be the first one in Scotland, and that would play a massive role in the decarbonisation of Scotland alone, and also present huge opportunities. So again, looking at kind of an investment over $2 billion over the lifetime of the project, but not only that, but also the opportunities that would be there for workers in that. And then also in terms of meeting Scotland's net zero targets, it would play a huge part to that. As both Emma and Maggie have just mentioned, in terms of the floating wind technology and also transmission's critical deployment and, again, you know, the investment that's there, but also the workforce that's needed for that too. If we look at Sea Green off the coast of Montrose, you're talking about 500 jobs that are there alone. And, of course, looking at newer kind of technologies, so alongside the carbon capture at Peterhead, looking at the potential for hydrogen there as well. And the network's playing a critical role in this. You know, it's all right to generate all of this energy, but how do we get it, you know, to the grid, and how do we do get it out so that it can actually be used? So there's huge opportunities. It's, as you say, not just the offshore, that I suppose that's the one that is very visible and people kind of know about, but there's a lot of new technologies, and things are always advancing and constantly moving forward. So it's being able to ensure for Scotland and the northeast region in particular that those opportunities are grasped and taken on. And in order to do that, as Maggie had mentioned earlier, you need, again, the correct infrastructure around that. So the planning, consenting piece, you know, all of these, if we look at kind of the timescale for any of these large infrastructure projects, you know, from start to end, it can be up to 12 years, for example, you know, when you're looking at kind of a wind farm being built out, and particularly along the transmission networks as well, the timescale around those. So again, when we're looking at all of these pieces, so we need the people to be trained and ready, we need the projects to be able to be up and running, and all of this needs to happen in order for us to meet the targets that have been set within a certain time scale. So it's looking at all of the components and creating the right environment for, I suppose, all of this to come together at the right time to ensure that it all happens. And it takes all of the various parties and players in that, whether it's government, whether it's a local authority, whether it's companies, communities, all of those needing to be within those conversations to ensure that this happens.
I think we talked about, you know, to deliver on innovation, it strikes me you can't have people working in the oil and gas sector and working in the green energy sector. So we need to have an influx of new talent to come into the sector. So, I mean, we've talked about STEM again, and we've talked about STEM since ever I came into this place, and we still are sitting at a very, very low uptake in women into STEM. So, in terms of that, you know, that to me, that's where the biggest innovation has to happen, and how do we over the, we're talking about 2045. So, in that timescale, Emma, how do we practically deliver that STEM training into that innovation encouragement into schools to deliver on our 2045 targets?
I think that's, I mentioned collaboration earlier, I think that's where the collaboration comes in between sort of industry and government to ensure that the STEM programmes, it's looking at both sides of the coin, it's looking at, you know, what skills do we need and what are available, and then using that information to map out where to direct investment in training facilities in the right areas, but working closely together across the sector and government around, you know, that local school engagement, but even at colleges and higher education. I think one thing that's just not been picked up on in terms of skills development and maximising the economic benefit from renewable energy projects is the ports and the supply chain, and I think ports can create skills hubs and offer lots of green jobs, and I think investment in ports is crucial for maximising the economic benefit from renewable energy. They are the linchpin to delivering whether it be offshore wind or green hydrogen projects, and you know, lots of the ports themselves already across Scotland and in the North East are investing. You know, we've seen investment in the new South Harbour at the Port of Aberdeen, which will create new clean green jobs there, and we've seen investment in the Port of Nigg and sort of across the O&M bases as well, and Montrose and Eyemouth and Buckey. So I think the ports are really key there, and supporting them as green skills hubs will help to, you know, move that dial forward in terms of skills development. And a lot of those ports, as I mentioned, the Port of Montrose, they're delivering their own STEM activity. So it's a collective effort of all of those supply chain businesses, as well as the developer community and the Scottish Government coming together, you know, and implementing all of those STEM activities, getting the schools involved, getting the colleges involved, and also the SME community. They're hugely important here. As I mentioned, you know, a lot of them are, you know, starting their apprenticeship schemes, and they're getting young people into the workforce and skilling them up, and other technologies as well. We've got lots of SMEs in the heat space, and heat pumps are very new, and a lot of them are launching apprenticeships for low carbon heat pumps, and offering that skill set I think is key as well. So the SME community are really important in terms of that upskilling piece as well. So it's a collective effort, I guess, in summary, across the sector, the SME community, the ports, the developer community and government at Scottish and UK level.
Have I got time, convener, just to bring Mr. Boland in for
briefly, yeah, if you could be brief.
One of the things that I wanted to go back to what you said, Mr. Boland, was around, you know, an electrical engineer in the oil and gas sector compared with the renewable sector, it could be, the difference could be as much as £20,000, and that would be, you know, specifically because oil and gas sector is very highly paid jobs over and above what you would expect potentially for that of an electrical engineer. How on earth do we square that circle if we're talking about a just transition, when to move from one sector to another will indicate a big drop in salary?
Yeah, I mean, I think whether they're highly paid, I suppose it would be a dubious thing, because again, you're looking at the working conditions and that as well. So that's a lot of that takes it on board, and that's why we had this somewhat problem previously with oil and gas industry being able to attract people, and that's what created the actual wages and that are actually there now. But this week I looked at some of the adverts that were there, and that was like for renewables and particularly like offshore wind. And you're looking at that, and a lot of the actual salaries that have been advertised and where they are being advertised are very similar to what's on onshore, but they're looking for people to actually work offshore on rotations. So I would find it, they're going to find it difficult to actually recruit people into these roles. It's certainly not going to be something that's going to encourage somebody from an offshore industry to actually move to that. And I think there needs to be a realisation that was realised in the oil and gas industry. If you are going to be working 14 days, 21 days, 12-hour shifts offshore, away from your family, there's got to be a degree of compensation for actually doing that. That I don't think is in the renewable industry at the moment, and that's our opinion on that. How you round that up, I think actually the market will do it themselves, because as we spoke earlier, there is a small pool of actually skilled people there, and the skilled people generally, in my experience, will go where the money is. And if the money's not there, then industries will find that there is a skill shortage, and the only option they're going to have is to actually compete with the other industries that are actually paying higher wages.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Gordon MacDonald, followed by Murdo Fraser.
Thanks very much, convener. My apologies for being late to the committee this morning due to traffic. Much of what I was going to ask has been touched upon, but I wanted to ask a couple of specific questions. First to you, John. You've mentioned a couple of times about the need for this universal training passport so that people can come from oil and gas industry into predominantly wind at the moment. Can you give us an idea of what the cost is for somebody who is trying to do that transition without the universal training passport?
It would be approximately £2,000, because at the moment they're having to go through their separate survivals. Now, there is elements that are different, we accept that, but a lot of it is very similar. And what we've been calling on this for a number of years, because there is people interested in offshore wind, but even if they're within an existing employer in offshore oil and gas, they're not going to pay for them to do the certification and move someplace else, so they're going to have to actually fund that themselves. And £2,000 is a lot of money for somebody to fund to go into our industry if they don't know if they're going to get a job. Plus also, if you have got people that have been made redundant of that, then it's even a bigger burden from them, and there is no actual support for actually get that training to actually do that as well. So,
okay, thanks so much. You know, during this transition period, which will go on for a reasonable long length of time, especially since the UK government has put out more licences for oil and gas, we have to juggle the fact we need workers in the oil and gas industry for the next 10, 20 years. We need workers for offshore wind, and that's proven to be pretty successful at the moment. We generate a surplus of electricity in Scotland, which we use
send south of the border, and there is huge scope for hydrogen. So, you know, Colin Beattie already touched upon the fact that we have difficulty in maybe attracting enough workers. So I'm aware that only 36% of people in the oil and gas industry in the UK are in Scotland. What is the UK government doing to try and tackle this problem, given that only 36% of oil and gas workers are in the UK, are in Scotland?
Our estimates are around about near a 50-50% actually split between Scotland and England, mainly, predominantly in Scotland in the north east and some in the actual southern west as well, but in England it's usually the north east and north west of England as well where there is. Sorry, could you repeat the question?
Just basically wanting to know, you know, the call has been upon what the Scottish Government should do, but what I'm saying is the oil and gas industry in the UK, whether you, it's your own figure of 50-50 or whether it's the oil and gas UK's figure of 36%, a lot of the workers that are working in oil and gas are not coming from Scotland, they're coming from elsewhere. So what is the UK government doing to attract, to tackle some of the problems that is facing the industry, the energy industry?
In my view, very little. I mean, there needs to be, this is, as you say, this workforce comes from across the whole of the UK. So obviously, it's a big issue for Scotland because oil and gas is off the shoreline of Scotland, but it's a big issue for the whole UK as well, because if these jobs go, it will affect communities across the whole of the UK. And we've seen that previously in previous downturns. So yes, it needs to actually, the UK government's input to actually support that and support things moving forward. As I say, they are involved in the skills passport discussions and that as well. But I feel there needs to be a wee bit more drive in that, right, in my opinion.
Does anybody else want to come in on that? Yep, Maggie.
And I think where we've seen real success has been where there have been joint UK and Scottish government. So the Aberdeen City Region deal would be a good example of that, where that led to the establishment of the Oil and Gas Technology Centre, as it was called then. It's now called the Net Zero Technology Centre. And, you know, that's delivered a huge amount in terms of technology development for net zero as well as for oil and gas. And the investment zone status for the northeast of Scotland, again, joint working between Scottish and UK government. And from my own perspective, the energy transition zone we're involved in has both got UK and Scottish government funding. So I do think where there's a combined effort, recognising what outcomes actually we're all looking to deliver, and therefore how we can best utilise different levers to deliver those outcomes can really make an impact.
Okay. Anybody else want to come in?
Yeah. No, I just
concur. So my second point is, you know, oil and gas workers have transferable skills in that if they don't have work in the UK, they can go to the Gabon, they can go to Venezuela, they can go all over the world. And vice versa, people can come here. So, you know, again, Oil and Gas UK report highlighted that in recent years, 27% of EU workers in the North Sea have left, and 54% of non-EU workers have left, around about 3,000 jobs in total. What needs to change in the UK immigration system in order to attract workers so that we can juggle the three balls of offshore wind, oil and gas and hydrogen?
I wouldn't be able to speak to the immigration system on that one, so I
is there a need for foreign workers?
In terms of going back to, again, the figures I presented earlier for SSE, so just speaking specifically for SSE, at the moment, people are transitioning to us. So we're, you know, the roles that are needed are being filled for now. I don't have figures on those people's immigration status that have taken up roles with us. So there could be people that are from outside of Scotland. I'm sure there is amongst them, but I don't know. But I suppose in terms of that point, that's what I would say, that for now, looking at that rather than at a national level and maybe what the situation would be in that instance, but speaking to SSE's experience for now, the transition is happening at a pace which is great for now.
I mean, the North Sea oil and gas industry has been a global industry,
yeah,
and we've seen, you know, the benefit to Scotland because so many people have spent their time all over the world, brought that knowledge and expertise back, and vice versa. Our university sector hugely benefit from that. So in terms of income from students coming to study, and because they recognise that Scotland has got really strong credentials in offshore energy in particular, that brings real benefit in terms of the student experience and both and their universities. So where we'd like to get to for renewables is it becomes successful globally, as we've seen oil and gas has been for Scotland. So success would look like floating offshore wind, and all the knowledge and capability and know-how we've built up in Scotland can be exported around the world. So it stands to reason that having that sort of mobile and global outlook is really important for the success of the industries.
Yeah. Okay, thanks so much.
Thank you. Myrtle Fraser to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I'd just like to change direction a little bit and ask about the Just Transition Fund. And we took some evidence last week. We heard from some community groups who benefited from the fund. We also heard different views on the way the fund was being administered by the Scottish National Investment Bank. So I suppose I'd like to start by asking you, do you have any particular view on the Just Transition Fund in the generality? Do you think it's appropriate that it's being handled by the Scottish National Investment Bank as opposed to any other body? And do you think there's enough transparency around the fund and the way that it is being administered? John?
It's not an area of my expertise. The only involvement I've had in the Just Transition Fund has been regarding Skills Passport, where I think there was $5 million from the Just Transition Fund put into that, which obviously has helped to actually try and move that forward. If it comes into place, then I would say it would be a good example, a good success. It's just, I suppose my question would be, what checks and balances are done by the Scottish Government to ensure that money is being used and they're getting the value for that?
Okay, thank you, MD. Mia? Oh, right, Maggie, yes.
Oh. Well, we've been delivering Just Transition Fund projects, so
right.
If I can give a perspective from there. So we successfully bid for Supply Chain Pathway and Challenge Fund, and that is really to help supply chain companies, and talking mainly about small to medium-sized companies, to understand the nature and scale of opportunities coming for in offshore wind, green hydrogen, etc. And then to help them think about what investments they need to make to make sure that they can go after those opportunities. So what investment do they need to make in capital equipment and building and infrastructure, etc. So the Challenge Fund part of that has been grant funding. Has supported 11 companies for the first pilot, and we're just about to announce another 14 companies who've benefited from that. So that's been about $3 million in grant funding that has levered another $5 million in private sector funding, and most importantly, of course, is delivering and maintaining jobs and also reduction in emissions, which will all be monitored and evaluated. We believe that's delivering impact. And we were fortunate that that was given as a 3-year project. So we have been able to employ someone to deliver the Supply Chain Pathway and Challenge Fund and make sure that it's delivering benefit to the supply chain and therefore into jobs as well. So having that multi-year view has been really helpful. The other project has been the Energy Transition Skills Hub. That's been $4.5 million from the Just Transition Fund, additional funding from Scottish Government ETF Fund, and as I said, $1.8 million from Shell and Nesco operating that. So that's going to be a physical infrastructure, an Energy Transition Skills Hub, to make sure we're able to provide skills for the future. So we feel they're really tangible examples of how the Just Transition Fund is being used very positively. And there's also been funding for the National Energy Skills Accelerator, which I've touched on already. So they would be real practical examples. I think the SNIB funding and financial transactions is helpful for a certain scale of company looking to do things. What I'd really ask is that we can think about what's the future of the Just Transition Fund, because for any of us involved in bidding for it, we need to know what that looks like over the next 3 to 5 years so that we can plan accordingly, get the right projects in place. It's very difficult if it's annual funding, and often the actual projects don't start until October, and you've got until the end of March to deliver, and that brings with it a whole raft of pressures. So being able to have a line of sight to what the Just Transition funding looks like, for it to be multi-year, for it to be a mix of grant and financial transactions. Financial transactions have a place, but they don't always work, and particularly not if we're trying to encourage more innovation and R&D amongst small to medium-sized companies. I think the grant funding is really important there. I think there have been challenges around the IP and where that resides, and I think if we really want to, again, make an impact with funding, the IP has to be with the IP or originator. So I think it's been, so I would concur, it's been really helpful, it's delivering impact, but we now need to know where it's going and what the future looks like for it to then be able to collectively really make sure that we're delivering impact from it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. That's a very helpful and comprehensive answer. In terms of innovation and new technologies being developed, do you think that there's enough awareness from companies in the sector around the Just Transition Fund, and how easy is it for people to access that funding?
Do you mean from the Scottish National Investment Bank? Mm-hmm. So the recent tranche?
Yeah.
I think it's mixed. I'd say it's mixed. I mean, I think there's a wider issue for small to medium-sized companies that they do. And the Aberdeen Grampian Chamber of Commerce survey that was just announced yesterday, I think, reiterates this. It's quite difficult for small to medium-sized companies to know and have the time to work out where all the different funding streams are. And that's a real challenge. So there's definitely something for helping it easier for small to medium-sized companies to understand what the different funding options are that are available to them and how they go and access them. So, for example, we've discussed with SNIB, do we put on a roadshow for supply chain companies to come and find out what does Scottish Enterprise offer, what does SNIB offer, et cetera, et cetera. So I think it's more about the visibility of the funding and helping make it easy for companies to understand what's available.
Okay, thank you. That's really helpful. Somebody else want to add? Yes, Emma.
Yeah. Just adding on the sort of SME point, I agree with everything Maggie said. I think the fund has been impactful, and some of the things it's delivered have been really positive. But I think in terms of future and where it's directed, I think it's that SME community and supporting them. I mean, I mentioned before, SMEs are the backbone of the supply chain, particularly in renewable energy. And there, I guess there's two areas to supporting them. There's a sort of scaling up, enabling them to grow and increase their competitiveness and invest in their facilities and in skills and in the equipment that they may need. So there's a grant funding side to that, but there's also a support for supply chain in terms of scaling up, in terms of business improvement. There are some great initiatives ongoing, and Maggie mentioned the enterprise agencies and things like that, but through the Offshore Wind Growth Partnership, there is a great holistic business improvement programme, and I think supporting businesses in that effect to grow their businesses and establishing a offshore wind supply chain development scheme to help them go through programmes like that and scale up is really important. So, yeah, I think in terms of future for the fund and supporting SMEs, it's really key to have those two sides of the coin, the funding and then the support.
Thank you.
Just very briefly, we're very supportive of the fund and its ambitions. To date, we haven't interacted with the fund, but we would encourage government maybe to look at the role of enabling infrastructure, such as the ports that Emma had mentioned earlier, that are so crucial to ongoing operations. So just being able to look at that, or a new offshore wind supply chain fund to focus on kind of port upgrades as well. So maybe incorporating that into the shape or the frame of it going forward.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Maggie Chapman. Thanks very much, Claire. And good morning to the panel. Thank you for your comments so far. I want to just extend the conversation around the Just Transition Fund, and then I've also got a couple of questions on supply chain, well, extend supply chain discussion and on community engagement. On the JTF, I'm wondering, when we talk about the wider supply chain, and Emma, you've just talked there about the importance of SMEs in the energy supply chains, how targeted do you think we should be thinking of the Just Transition Fund in terms of supply chain support specifically in this?
Yeah, I think it should be very targeted towards supporting those businesses, because I mentioned, I think, you know, those businesses are where the green jobs are created, so SMEs are huge, and May had just mentioned the ports as well. There's a lot of work going on in the sector about ports and investment, and, you know, through the SNIB and the strategic investment model, but as I said earlier, ports are the linchpin of our offshore renewables activity, and supporting them is hugely key, because the growth of ports will have a knock-on effect on the wider supply chains that the ports use. So using them to maximise economic benefits from renewables is really important. So, yeah, I think it should be very targeted towards SMEs and supply chain.
And I suppose if we think about the supply chain of the broader economy, you talked about and you highlighted some companies that are already doing this. Do you think that there needs to be an understanding that actually they should be seen as part of this broader, the broader remit of the fund as well? So we're not just focused on the energy economy, we're focused on everything that supports that as well.
Yeah, so I mean, many businesses that are in the supply chain are not just working in renewables, they'll be working in rail, they'll be working in the defence sector, they'll be working in the food and drink. I mean, you know, there's so many businesses that have actually transitioned from food and drink into oil and gas and now into renewables. So it is a whole holistic thing, you know, more skills in other areas and more capabilities in fabrication and perhaps oil and gas is development within renewables as well. So, yeah, I agree with you there that it is a sort of holistic approach on the supply chain.
Okay, thanks. Mia, if I can come to you, a similar question around how we can support or what the barriers to for the renewable supply chain that you see. Where are the barriers? And other than the JTF, what are the kinds of either incentives or things that the government needs to be looking at to support supply chain development, not as well as supply chain activity, to support renewables?
To support renewables. I suppose in terms of, I think Emma has kind of covered very well a lot of the work that's being done, but it's in terms of being able to, I suppose, encourage them like that to be able to access where there is various funds that maybe would support the work they're doing, being able to kind of give guidance. I suppose one of the things we would be looking at in terms of, are you saying in terms of their, sorry, could you repeat the question?
Yeah, no, I suppose we hear quite a lot about challenges in the supply chain and understanding where those challenges come from, what the barriers are and how we can unpick them. But there's also, you know, there's money obviously is one thing, but do we actually understand the broader strategic landscape of Scotland's supply chain, thinking, you know, in broad terms of our renewables industry, not just the very very specific links, but that's kind of broader strategic picture.
So in terms of, I suppose, the kind of the project pipeline, so for the supply chain to be involved, being able to have certainty about the pipeline and what is coming down the tracks in terms of them being able to kind of plan out, so looking at streamlined planning and consenting processes to support that. Strategic funding, you've made mention of the Just Transition Fund there, but looking at other areas where supports for kind of new innovation and new technologies within the supply chain can be supported, and also looking at kind of circularity would be one as well, so work with the industry to establish a circular approach for replacing onshore and offshore wind components, and wider than that as well, as you say, if it isn't just within the core kind of areas, and being able to establish targets potentially around kind of the reuse and refurbishing and remanufacturing, and within this being able to kind of support that wider workforce growth in terms of kind of that new industry around the circularity piece. And then again, going back to the ports piece in terms of being able to support the supply chain, so enabling the infrastructure. So Scottish ports again playing a crucial role in delivering net zero, and being able to unlock that supply chain. So the investment around the upgrading of any of those infrastructures as well.
Remanufacturing, do we support actual primary manufacturing enough in Scotland to have not only the jobs that are associated with that, but also maybe make those supply chains more reliable, more resilient, and more adaptable if they are locally controlled?
Yeah, I suppose in the first instance that would be the key priority, but then again as we move out, being able to kind of look at that circularity piece and being able to really kind of, I suppose, build an infrastructure around that. So at the moment it is quite exploratory in certain areas, you know, things are very at initial stage and kind of very much pre-development almost. So being able to, again, when we look at where we are with the skills shortage, and we're now doing the things in STEM in the schools in order to have people kind of, you know, ready and prepared for 10 years' time, being able to look now at what is needed around that circularity piece to ensure that there's more development and more growth in that area.
OK, thanks. John, if I can come to you, similar question around trade union engagement with or discussions with your colleagues around where support is needed to secure supply chains, to make them resilient, to make them sort of long term. Do you have any comments on that?
I mean, supply chains are obviously vital because the amount of people that they actually employ. I think some of the things that we touched on around about the visibility of work, which is a problem for supply chains and seeing what the actual work is going to actually be there. But again, as I say, from our point of view, a big movement would be that actual manufacturing, having that manufacturing base within Scotland. I think we'd actually create work for the supply chains. It would create jobs that would be more in the near term as to the longer term, and would hopefully fill some of the gaps that we're seeing at the moment.
And do you see that as being, you know, you said create jobs and secure jobs, you see that being across different industries and different sectors as well, not just focused on energy?
Yes, yeah, I think it would actually, as has been said before, the supply chain works in various different sectors. So actually having that manufacturing base would support all these sectors as well.
Thanks. Maggie, if I can come to you. Nice to say hello to another Maggie again. Similar question around supply chains, and from ETZ's point of view, where are the barriers in ensuring that we have the support for manufacturing, the support for the running through of supply chains across your activities?
So I think supply chains, first of all, a lot of the indigenous supply chain companies who have predominantly built up their expertise around oil and gas, one of the challenges they face is that if they do want to make new investment to be ready for offshore wind or other green energy opportunities, they often don't have the actual contract for that work in place. Mm-hmm. Because the ScotWind projects, for example, are still going through their own final investment decisions. So therefore, there is a risk that there'll be a bit of a gap because the supply chain companies can't get the funding because they don't have confirmed contracts, so therefore can't make the investment that's needed now, but then are expected to be ready in 2026, 27, mm-hmm. when the contracts come from the developers, for example.
Okay.
So that is a real issue that I think if there's some way that government can try and maybe get their heads around that and see if there's anything that can be done, because I do think there's a worry that some supply chain companies can't put in the investment they know they need to do to get ready, for example, offshore wind. But by the time they get the confirmed orders, they're not going to be then ready for the developer. So yeah. There's something to try and unpick that is quite difficult. Now, that's to an extent where the Just Transition Challenge Fund that I mentioned earlier, where it was grant funding, has helped unlock that to a bit. But, you know, it can only do so much.
Okay.
So that is the challenge. We then look at inward investment. So John mentioned about gaps. So where there are gaps in the supply chain, that is well understood now. And so it's ensuring we've got a coordinated effort, which we do have with Scottish Development International and Department of Business and Trade, about where there are opportunities, which sort of companies we should be attracting, and where the best locations are for those companies, depending on what sort of requirements they have in terms of scale or workforce. So having that very coordinated effort around inward investment to attract new investment into Scotland is an important part of the supply chain. So both how do we grow our Indigenous supply chain as we're transitioning, and how do we attract new investment as well?
Okay, thank you. That's really helpful. If I can move on to my second area of questions around community engagement. It was interesting right at the start of this conversation this morning when we were talking about what the definition of just transition was and the role of businesses, of companies, of communities and of workers. The Just Transition Lab based at Aberdeen University talks very, very clearly about the role of equality and well-being, of democratic participation and of community empowerment revitalisation as being integral, not something that's a nice add-on extra, but being fundamental and integral to the just bit of just transition. And Maggie, if I can stay with you, we at our community engagement session last week, and we've had conversations about at St Fiddick's Park before. Yep. You know, there's a very, very clear sense of injustice. Old Torrey was cleared for oil, for the oil and gas industries in the 70s. Torrey has the incinerator, the Aberdeen Sewage Works. It's just lost its beach to the South Harbour development. How do you see your role with ETZ and the community engagement, focusing particularly on the community justice point of view of ETZ's operations? Yeah.
So we see very clearly our role as ETZ Limited is about how we both support the business to be successful, but how we support the community around about that to be successful. So particularly the Torrey community, as you've said. So we have got in place a raft of suggestions of projects to do, because this is really important that the community wants those projects and that they're not imposed. We've got a range of mitigation measures in place. We're also working on a community fund. So again, it's about supporting the community and projects that the community want to see. There's a jobs and skills plan in place, and we can circulate that round to the committee if that would be helpful. But that sets out very clearly how we can ensure that, for example, if there's an inward investor coming in, how we'd ensure that a lot of those jobs and those benefits would go back into the local community. So that would be about specifically about apprenticeships, about a guaranteed interview scheme that Aberdeen City Council runs already. We have got a community lead, and her role is to work directly with communities at a very individual level, understanding what issues are important. We're also working to look at the whole landscape vision of the whole area for the energy transition zone. So it's how the need for green spaces, the need for biodiversity, the need for active travel sits firmly alongside supporting what the community wants, but also what we need to attract an industry and a workforce around that. So it's looking at this in a holistic way, but ensuring that we listen to industry community concerns, that we listen to industry needs, and that we try and work that together to get to deliver the right outcome for everybody, which is understanding what the community wants, but also understanding how we deliver jobs and sustainable jobs for the future, and also don't miss out on these big economic opportunities for Aberdeen and the region as well. So there's a balance in all of that.
Okay, you talked about mitigations and the balance. Yeah. I suppose the argument that some in Torrey would make is that they've already been compromised, for 50 years, yeah. losing houses, losing community facilities, and there isn't really a mitigation to losing the last remaining green space. You know, there isn't once it's gone, it's gone. You know, the wetlands there as well. And given the importance of, if we are genuine about our intention of a just transition, we know that life expectancy in Torrey can be up to 10 years lower than just across the river. Loss of that green space is more than just, you know, trees and grass. It's wetlands. It's about genuinely healthy community. Absolutely. Or supporting that. So I suppose, how do you see those mitigations actually making up for the potential destruction of the last remaining green space? Yeah.
So the proposal is not to destroy the last remaining green space. The proposal is the local development plan was approved by Scottish Government and the Aberdeen City Council. And we've worked very hard to look at how we can minimise the use of the green space, but to maximise the economic impact from it. So it's proposing to use just under a third of the St Fiddick's Park and the area next to the wastewater treatment works. It's not about losing the wetlands, it's about retaining the burn and the wetlands, and in fact improving the wetlands and improving the water quality. It's about improving the accessibility to the park. And also importantly, it's about putting in place a maintenance so that the park can be maintained, because there's great work done by the community around the wetlands, but mm-hmm. it's not maintained well, and there's a lot of invasive species, etc. So how do we put in place a plan that actually looks about the maintenance and improvement of the green space that will remain there, and do that in a way that's very much what the community wants to see? So therefore, it's about improving the quality of the green space. And it's also looking at how we can improve accessibility to the neighbouring green spaces. So, for example, Talus Woods is a great lung in the heart of the city, but at the moment it's not particularly safe. It's not well lit. You'll get lost. So there's very clear things that can be done to improve paths, networks, and signposting, lighting, safety, improve how the historic churchyard is maintained, etc. So what we really have done is engaged extensively with the community to understand the concerns, and there are many concerns, and how best we can help mitigate and or put in place a long-term plan that will look to overall make improvements overall.
Okay, thanks. And one final short
question.
It's
very brief. Yeah. I'll still have Kevin Stewart to ask a question.
Okay. Thanks. And coming back to you, John, it's on this community engagement piece. Do you think that there's been enough conversation with, engagement with, and actually listening to workers and the communities that they come from and support in the just transition in the round?
No. If you want a simple answer, because probably if you ask most workers regarding the just transition, they struggle to tell you what it is. And we had that kind of discussion right at the very start, trying to define what a just transition is. So what workers are interested in is having the security of a job. That's what they see. And if that's what just transition is, then they'll be happy with that.
Thanks.
Kevin Stewart, did you wish to...?
Yeah, please. Thank you, convener. And there's been quite a lot of talk today around about collaboration. And we've just touched upon communication, and that's what I want to concentrate on today, collaboration and communication. So let's start with collaboration, because I think it's in all of our interest to ensure that the North East doesn't just survive, but that it continues to thrive. And I think that most folk from our area would agree that that should be the case. In order to get to that point, we all have to collaborate. And you have talked today, particularly Ms. Harrick, around about the collaboration that exists across the industry. Is there enough collaboration, though, between governments, Scottish, UK, industry, academia, communities, in order for us to get this right? And let me give you an example, because Ms. McCarthy said that it took sometimes 12 years to get a major project all the way through from planning to consent. And we recognise that we don't have a huge amount of time in terms of this transition. What do we need to do in terms of that collaboration to get governments, all of the rest, industry, communities, to understand that we need to do this a little bit more speedily than we're currently doing, and be a little bit more flexible as we move forward? And maybe Ms. McGinley would like to answer first.
Thank you. So I agree, collaboration is absolutely critical. And, you know, I think there's good levels of collaboration. And I mean, I can name lots of examples. And I'd say particularly in North East, the Regional Economic Strategy, which really provides the framework against which the Just Transition funding and everything else should be looked at, is an example of collaboration and practice amongst all private and public sector. I agree. I feel we need the shared sense of what outcomes are we looking to deliver for the Scottish economy, and therefore how do we all play to our strengths to deliver against those outcomes? So what's the role of Scottish Government, UK Government, role of industry, role of organisations like ourselves, public sector, etc.? Because I think if we had that shared plan, then that really helps to focus minds and make sure that we can all play to our strengths. So I think collectively we all know what needs to be done to unlock the low carbon and green energy opportunity. But for some reason, there's just, you know, I don't think there's a clear action plan about what action is everyone taking so that we can all play to our strengths and deliver against that.
Okay. Does anyone else want to come in on that? Ms. Harrick, please.
I agree with Maggie that there is, you know, a good collaboration going on. I think one of the good examples is the strategic investment model that I mentioned, which is around port investment, and that's bringing together the developers of Scotland as well as the Scottish Government to see how we can progress investment in ports. So, you know, that's a really important step there, but I think expanding that further to, you know, the financial community to unlock investment through guarantee schemes and things like that is really important. But also just to pick up on Maggie's point about setting the direction, you know, the industry welcomed the draft energy strategy and just transition plan as a sort of potentially transformative piece of work, which was due in spring 2022. So, you know, that's a delay of more than 2 years. So I think setting out that plan and getting that published to set the direction is really key. So just picking up on Maggie's point there about that plan and that direction. But yeah, absolutely agree that collaboration is key, but I think it starts at that plan stage.
Okay. You know, a number of you have talked today about port infrastructure, and, you know, that is extremely important as we move forward. But, you know, some of these changes to ports are quite controversial. South Harbour in Aberdeen did not get by without a wee bit of controversy, but I think now the vast majority of people would agree that it was the right thing to do, not only for Aberdeen, but for the whole of the North East as we move forward. And we can already see business transferring to Aberdeen that would not have come there before. So how do we get around these often controversial projects? How do we explain to communities the necessity of some of these changes in order that we get to the stage of not only surviving, but thriving? I don't know who wants to answer that, because I think business has got a big part to play in that communication with communities.
I think in terms of the that engagement piece, when you say how do we explain to communities, I think it kind of needs to take a step back, and in terms of the initial engagement that takes place, Maggie, Ms. Tappan, you had mentioned around the Aberdeen University and their research, and we're involved in a collaboration at the moment in Aberdeen, which involves Aberdeen University as well as others, but very much key to all of that is having that representation from community to be able to lend their voice to the discussions. Because as you've said, historically, you go back to the 70s, 80s and 90s, in particular parts of Aberdeen city itself and the surrounding areas, people have felt kind of put upon and not engaged in the process of the transformation or transition. So you can have all these great ideas, what would be lovely for a community, but if you don't actually go and speak to the people and present your ideas, you know, you could be doing completely the opposite of what they need. But also recognising, I suppose, that within a community is very diverse and made up of many different thoughts and, you know, people and backgrounds and all the rest of it. And sometimes it's those who shout loudest that maybe their voices are heard and others who should be heard aren't heard. So it's an intricate process that needs to be worked through very carefully to ensure that nobody gets left behind and to ensure that maybe those voices that aren't being amplified are heard. But also at the end of all of this, there is certain, for business, there is certain remits that we have to work in. So whether that is around the planning and consenting process from an authority. So, you know, we will set out to engage and to include and to collaborate on all of that, but there is of course always these external frameworks that also set what it is ultimately that you might need to do on something. But I think from the outset it is that having everybody's voice at the table, and that might sound a bit twee, and that's it, you know, but it is actually true, because in order for us to be able to operate the way we do and to be able to build out the infrastructure that we do, we need to have the public support, you know, on board. And there will always be things that arise, but it's how we're kind of open and transparent and can engage with people that ensures that the process goes through.
You, Mr. Boland.
Yeah, I mean, if you're wanting the public support, then they need to see how it's going to benefit them and how it's going to directly benefit them. And I mean, we were speaking about in the early days of oil and gas in Aberdeen, but if you take another area, Shetland, for example, and how they dealt with that and the benefits that done to their actual local community, where you have leisure facilities in every village and that, which was actually funded from the Common Good Fund that they actually set up through that. So there is ways of actually doing things, and it brings actual communities with you because they see that overall there's a benefit to their community.
And as you said at the very beginning, this, in order to have thriving communities, you've got to have jobs. I want to move to certainty, which is difficult when you're in a change phase. But when governments themselves change tack at various points, as we have seen with the UK government in terms of its climate change ambitions being diluted. What does that do to industry in particular, that lack of certainty? What does that do in terms of investment, in terms of confidence amongst industry members themselves? Emma, do you want to go first on that, please?
Yeah, I mean, I think just starting off with some positives, you know, the Scottish Government have a Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero and Just Transition, you know, which signals a clear message there. And then the Just Transition Fund itself shows, you know, action, but further policy certainty is required. I mean, if there is uncertainty there, that investor confidence is challenged. And we have seen some disappointing announcements with Vattenfall, Norfolk, Boreas project, and things like that sort of falling out of the pipeline because of that uncertainty. So, as I mentioned earlier, the Energy Strategy and Just Transition Plan is key in having that plan to support that direction there. And we also look forward to seeing the Green Industrial Strategy that was announced as part of the programme for government from the First Minister. So policy pieces like that will go towards supporting that confidence and clarity. But coming from a supply chain point, that uncertainty challenges that investment piece we're talking about. Maggie mentioned earlier the gap between investing in ports or investing in your skills and capabilities. If you don't have a clear pipeline, then justifying that investment is much harder. Accessing private investment is much harder. So we need to ensure that that pipeline is certain. And to do that, that comes with addressing some of the challenges we've mentioned. And some of the key ones is grid and also the route to market at the UK level through the CFD and making sure there's investor confidence there and that the economic model is there. So, you know, without projects, there is no supply chain, there is no jobs. So it's making sure that that pipeline is there.
Anyone else want to come in on that? Maggie, please.
Yeah, the certainty and confidence is absolutely critical for investors, for companies who are looking to invest, but also for the workforce. We talked, going back, about the challenges of encouraging people into the energy industry. That doesn't help those people either if they're looking for career choices. I think the other thing is there's huge competition from what the States, what US is doing in terms of renewables and also in Europe. And this is a global market, and we are competing in a global market for supply chain, for people, and for the investment. So the certainty from UK and Scottish Government is really critical to make sure that that bit about this being a managed transition is not either or oil and gas and renewables, it's both, and it's a managed transition. That is so critical if we're going to be successful here, or else everything we've talked about, we won't reap the opportunities.
John, I think, wants to come in.
I would just agree with what's been said. Uncertainty doesn't help from a workforce point of view, because if it's a non-oil and gas, uncertainty could lead to a quicker end to some of the actual jobs that are there. And uncertainty in renewables will stop projects going ahead. So in both elements, then you're going to actually lose jobs.
Convener, just one final point.
We are very pressed for time.
I'll be very, very brief. Obviously, Aberdeen in the North East has been a real global player in terms of oil and gas, top of the tree. And I'm sure that we all want to see the same in terms of renewables in the future. There are lots of other questions that I could ask around about planning and consenting. And I just wonder, Convener, if the witnesses could do us the obligement of actually writing to us in terms of where they see planning and consenting could change to be beneficial for that just transition. And thank you, Convener.
Thank you. We did hear some evidence earlier on planning. If there's anything that the witnesses would like to give us in addition to what's already been said on the record, we'd happily receive that. I would like to thank the witnesses for their giving us their time this morning. You've been very generous with the time. And I'll suspend very briefly for changeover of witnesses. Thank you.
I now welcome our second panel of witnesses, Professor Paul DeLeo, who is Director at the Robert Gordon University's Energy Transition Institute, Gordon McGuinness, Director of Industry and Network Skills Development Scotland, and Suzanne Sosna, Director of Economic Opportunities and Climate with Scottish Enterprise. Welcome this morning. I'll start with the question I've posed to the first panel, which was around definitions of a just transition. That's an area that the committee is interested in as part of the inquiry. And if I come to you first, Paul, and what we're interested in is whether do you think there's a shared understanding in the North East and Moray of what the just transition is, and should we be measuring it, and how will we know it's been delivered?
Great question. The answer is no. I mean, again, there's a lot of people working and living, of course, in the air, and they all have a different flavour of just transition. But I've talked about it specifically around the workforce. And again, you've probably heard some things already from the first panel and previous sessions. We, on our estimates, 150,000, 160,000 people work in the industry, and they all have a slightly different flavour because they know what the end point is net zero, but they don't know they have a different starting point. So everybody's journey from the workforce is different. Everybody living in the area has a slightly different perspective. So I think maybe one thing would be really helpful is clarifying what is the destination and how can we help people with their journeys as they go through it, because people have a different starting point. They need clarity. Now, there's some great work done, including here in Scotland, around this transition planning framework, which put some really nice bullets around it. But I think we need a bit of Google translation to make it real for people, because they're lovely statements, but it's not really clear when you're a person in the street, a person in a job or work somewhere, what it's actually going to mean for them individually. So I think we need to help people on their journey towards a common destination.
Because a lot of the discussion this morning was around skills transition. It was about people who were in employment in the oil and gas sector moving over to the renewable sector. But what does it mean to call it a just transition? Is there different areas or different, you know, what should be measured in? What makes it not just a transition from one sector to the other, but makes it a just transition?
Yeah, and I think just building on what I said, change is hard, because change means we need to change our lifestyle, how we're going to do something. And people need to make different choices. Some people already live in a well-insulated home, others, like myself, do not. So therefore, you need a kind of, it's a different journey. So I think we need to say, what does just and fair mean? But I think that we also need a few more words. Managed and coordinated probably needs to add it to the definition, because actually this needs to be a very thoughtful managed transition. And again, when I look at the definitions of the National Just Transition Outcomes, actually the 8 definitions work for me. I can see that's a pretty good way to describe it. But remember, everybody's journey is different. So what a just transition means is something different to you than it means to me. I think we need to help people what actually how we translate and what is fair looks like.
Mm-hmm. And if I come to you, Suzanne, so this, because Paul's kind of described the transition as being, is it maybe being difficult to find a shared understanding because everybody's starting point is different. But what does that mean for, you know, policymakers or agencies like yourselves, if there's not a common understanding of what it is that we're trying to deliver and what it is we're trying to measure?
I think I would absolutely concur on the point you make about managed transition. I think in our view there is a very good collective understanding about the end goal. I think we can all see what's happened in the past, and that we understand that we don't want what's happened in the past. We want a new future where people are not damaged and badly affected by change. So we want to manage that change in order to mitigate the risks and reduce the possibility of that happening to people and to communities. I think from our perspective as well, a just transition is about the individual, but it's also about the collective, and it's also about the environment. So it's about the collective in the sense it's about communities, of course, but it's also about companies. So it's a just transition for companies. And if we think about it in those terms, so a company that's a supply chain company in the oil and gas sector, what is a just transition for them? How do they maintain and grow their turnover, their profitability? How do they retain their profitability, retain their staff, grow their skills? So it's a just transition for the company as well, and then for the sector, for the energy sector. And increasingly we talk about the energy transition sectors as to be inclusive of all the different component parts of that. And so we think about the just transition for the whole sector from a dependency on fossil fuels through to the new multifaceted energy sector I think we'll have. It will not be what we talked a lot about offshore wind, talked about hydrogen. There'll be lots of components of that, some more important in Scotland than others. But it won't just be one solution, it'll be different solutions for different applications. So it's thinking about it in the whole, and I really concur that, and we heard that from the first panel as well, having an end goal is great, but we need to have a roadmap. And that's what we all need to do together, is pull that roadmap together as to how we're going to get from here to there. And of course, there'll be all sorts of little journeys in that, but we need the plan to get us to that end point. I think the end goal, we have a lot of agreement around.
And has enough been done to set out a route map or to bring together the people who need to be speaking to each other to create that route map for Moray in the North East?
I think a lot has been done. I sometimes have the impression that in every meeting room in a building I'm in, people are having these kind of conversations. I think there is a vast amount of collaborations, a recognition from industry that there's enough in this for us all in terms of, you know, market share, that there are many, many opportunities, and therefore there's more ready collaboration than perhaps before. I don't know if we're quite there yet in terms of having that roadmap, though, because that, if we all have a consistent picture of how we're going to get there, obviously it'll change. As soon as you write a plan, it'll change, but we can all then get behind the same thing. So yes, there's a lot of collaboration, I think, more than ever before. I think somebody in the committee talked earlier about timelines. It took more than 50 years to build the oil and gas sector. We've been tremendously successful in that in the North East. It's been game-changing for Scotland, and it's hugely important. We recognise that. We don't have 50 years. Mm-hmm. This is a globally competitive environment we're in, and we just don't have the luxury of time. So I think there is a question of making planned but steady progress in that planning process as well, because, mm-hmm. you know, we can't take too long about it.
Mm-hmm. Gordon, if I come to you around a definition of a just transition, do you think that's a shared understanding, and how do you think we measure if we're being successful or not?
I think you ask the man in the street, then probably know it. I'm comfortable with the Just Transition Commission's definition in terms of that, the equitable journey, particularly for those whose livelihoods are impacted. I think we only need to look back at the Coldfield, close our minds, and the impact that had across community. It's brought up in Kilburnie, so we suffered the same when it was the steelwork closures. So that's how not to do it. I think in the North East we're very fortunate. We've got a well-paying industry that is going into a managed decline, and a fresh green industry that is growing, and that's a unique position to be in for the scale of employment. I've done a lot of stuff with Pace over the years. So it's always good if you've got a company closing that something else is starting up. But we can see this on a regional level. So I think there's a lot of optimism. Timing is a challenge, and I guess for some of the new companies coming, they are coming to Scotland new, so things like apprenticeships, it's a four-year programme, so there's a challenge in terms of when they will arrive and when they then can commit to start recruiting and developing certainly the young workforce. And that gap period in between, that's when people at Scottish Enterprise, SDI and ourselves will have to be working hard around other labour market interventions that we can bring and support the companies, the stuff that Suzanne and her team will do with supply chain development.
Mm-hmm. Paul, if I can just come back to you before I move to Colin Smith. Do you think, I know you've said it's kind of down to, or it can be different things for different people or different sectors, but do you think there's enough being done to create a route map or, you know, recognise progress points? Or do you think we need that kind of framework? We all know what the end point is, but do you think there needs to be more done to set out how we get there?
We had the pleasure of writing a report last year called Making the Switch, which was particularly focused around the energy transition in the northeast of Scotland, actually written for the Scottish Government. And we have outlined four scenarios for the region. Anywhere from a global energy hub, you know, whatever we do in oil and gas now, we do for renewables on steroids, to something what we call regional decline, not as similar to a coal or steel town, what Gordon was talking about earlier on. So you have a huge range of outcomes. And there's a real shift happening. And the reason why I say that, maybe I'll add a few words around that. If you look at the workforce in the northeast of Scotland, and this is Aberdeen, Aberdeenshire, roughly one in five of the people who work there either work or support the oil and gas industry and the offshore energy industry. If you do the induced jobs, it's one in three. So if the energy industry doesn't work, the region at the moment doesn't work. So we wrote this report and saying is, what are the outcomes between the best case, which is the global energy hub, and the worst case, which is kind of regional decline. And again, they're very stark outcomes. One is around, currently is around one in five, 45,000 people plus or minus a bit work in the offshore energy industry. If we get it right, collectively, we end up with 20% more people. If we get it wrong, we lose 40% of the people by 2030. This is a hugely clear kind of cut outcome. And so do we have, back to your question, Convener, do we have a roadmap? I don't think we have a roadmap clear enough to get us to the winning outcome. I think we have a very good roadmap to get us not to the winning outcome, is called stop investing. And we're not investing enough in the oil and gas industry or in the renewables industry to get to the outcome we want. So is there more work to be done? Yes. Is there a good outcome for the region? Absolutely. But does it require kind of effort from all parties involved to get us there? Yeah, we certainly see that. And that's what we made very clear in our report last year. And again, if it hasn't been circulated, I would be delighted to get it to the committee after this.
Thank you. Colin Smith to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Can I kick off with some specific questions around the issue and the challenge of skill shortages? There was pretty much universal agreement from the energy sector and trade union representatives. We heard from this morning that we already face skill shortages within the energy sector. So maybe starting with yourself, Gordon. SDS and your submission state that the SDS and partners have developed a good understanding of the emerging picture. But could you say a bit more about what that actual emerging picture is? Where are those current and emergent shortages that are a threat to delivering that just transition?
I think for us, the shortages are not just in oil and gas. Aerospace and Prestwick, 450 vacancies. Shipbuilding and marine sector in the Clyde. We've got large numbers of foreign nationals working there at additional cost. So that's challenging. It's right across Scotland. Hinkley Point, it's got 22,000 people working on it just now. Lots of Scots down there in contracts. So these are big draws. And it's called a labour market for a reason, and it performs as a labour market. So oil and gas pay a premium. And that's why you hear from John, there's a reluctance from some people to move across into other, into renewable sectors. What we've done so far, we've worked with Opito and Opergy. We've done analysis that builds on the work that Paul and the team at RGU have done. And we've got teams just now working through data from Owicklof Shore Wind Industry Council. And that's in conjunction with the Scottish Offshore Wind Energy Council. So that's now the developers' plans. So there's now timelines in for when these things will happen. Now that's based on consenting processes and when plans will be approved. It's been touched on a couple of times here just now. There's a strategic collaborative framework where there's 44 bids into that being assessed just now for the amount up to £4 billion. That's for port and manufacturing facilities. These will all have, not the all 44 because they won't all get approved, but the developments of ports and harbours will then determine where these jobs actually go. So some of them could be in Ardersier, for example. They could be in more remote locations where things like accommodation are going to be more challenging. But it's going to be, and I think Scottish Renewables gave you a good list of where the job shortages were. But we're seeing real pressing demands around fabrication and welding just now as a basic skill, but it is through into consenters, environmental analysts, so we can come back with more of a detail on that and we can give you access.
I suppose it's
just
to get an understanding of the scale of this. I mean, is this a gap that realistically we can close?
I think it's going to be really challenging. But that's our task, is to do that, to use the people and the skills that we already have to help them transition across. But some of the numbers are really chunky. So we're working with, and Scottish Enterprise announced, announced on Monday, XLCC going into Hunterston, high voltage cable manufacturer, 900 jobs in one facility. You've got Sumitomo and Inverness will be 200 jobs. So these will be challenging, but they'll be over a period of next 5-6 years. So that will be our, I guess, case as a public sector agency to work alongside partners as part of Team Scotland and to try and manage that process for people, as well as turning on the taps in terms of training and development activity. I think we're short probably in areas, if we look down south, they have a transition boot camp type model, the DFEE fund. We don't really have anything like that in Scotland. That's a kind of 16-week model, and it'd probably be enough to get people up to a level of competence to do work. We've got a similar model that runs with Babcock at Rosyth and renowned production support operatives. So it's those agile interventions that we require to mobilise, but get them in the right areas and get training the right people, and probably trying to do more and making connections to those that are slightly more remote for the labour market.
Suzanne, this is obviously a massive threat to the just transition, the skill shortage that the businesses you must work with on a daily basis are facing. So how have Scottish Enterprise, I suppose, adapted to what you support businesses in doing to help them tackle that challenge?
I'll take a kind of wider picture then come to the energy sector. So it's a sort of wider picture in Scottish Enterprise. We've been focusing down on three areas as a whole organisation, so the 1,200 people in Scottish Enterprise. And it's across the areas that are all relevant to this conversation. One is about productivity, improving Scotland's productivity. The other is about scaling innovation. And the third is around realising the opportunities of the energy sector, the energy transition. So all of those things come to bear when we start to talk about the companies involved in the energy sector. So if I take the companies involved in the supply chain, the challenges are absolutely, as Gordon has outlined, they're writ even larger for SMEs, because SMEs are then competing with larger employers for the skills and to be able to retain people. And they may not have the margin flexibility to be able to pay them, so they have to look at the whole package of what they can offer. And there are some fantastic examples of really good practice with regards to retention of staff in the engineering sector, for example. So what Scottish Enterprise is doing, just to summarise it, is we see it as the first stage is making sure that companies are aware of the opportunities in the energy transition sectors. So that's offshore wind, and that's hydrogen, that's carbon capture, that's heat, that's the whole picture. And the approach we're taking is to look at capabilities. So instead of going to a given company and talking to them only about offshore wind, we're talking about the whole energy sectors, and so that if they've got capability that can serve one part of the market, they can also serve. So they could be selling, for example, to onshore and offshore wind. They could be selling to heat and onshore wind, etc. But also looking at the international opportunities that there might be for that company to try and even out the lumpiness of the orders. We've heard about the uncertainty of when orders are going to come through. We've heard about the risks of a stop-start environment where a company might get a contract 1 year but not the next. So we have to try and even that out by looking at how a company can internationalise their business to protect it from these risks. And to not talk too long about this, but what we're doing with the supply chain is really looking at working with 1,000 companies that we don't currently work with, who are either in the energy supply chain or potentially in the energy supply chain, to help them understand what they would need to do to achieve those contracts, enter those markets. So that's whether they need to invest in capital equipment, improve their productivity, and that could be through, Maggie McGinley talked earlier about robots, sorry, I shouldn't talk about robots, automation, sorry. Better practices in manufacturing to be more efficient, and that to some extent mitigates the skills shortage issues, because it might mean that fewer people are required and the jobs that are available are more highly skilled, more highly paid. So looking at investment and productivity, but also anything else a business might have to do in terms of its leadership,
It might have to expand its factory, might have to invest in equipment, etc., etc. So what Scottish Enterprise is doing, and we have, I can talk in more detail about it if needed, we have programmes for that, but we are targeting these supply chain companies to support them very specifically.
That's very helpful. I suppose any other information that you feel would be helpful to the committee, I'm sure you can send it on. Paul, your recent report pulling up that the workforce talks about the scale of the opportunity and risk for workers in the North East from that transition. What does Suzanne's agency and Gordon's agency and government need to do to make sure that they can meet the challenge you set out in that report?
Great question. And again, I'm not sure everybody's seen the report. Maybe pick a few things up to build on that. We've worked very closely with industry over the last kind of couple of months and put out this report, Powering Up the Workforce, 2 months ago. There's $200 billion to be spent between now and the back end of this decade in offshore and in the offshore business, oil and gas and renewables. Of that, $100 billion is already identified, and the other $100 billion is still to be approved. You know, still projects subject to approval. So therefore, there's an issue around this. We currently hold 154,000 people work in the offshore energy industry, direct and indirect. But depending on how much money you approve and how much gets done in the UK, the workforce could be the requirement, could be anywhere between 225,000, so 50% increase by 2030, or 130,000, a decline from what we currently have. So I don't jump automatically to the conclusion that we don't have enough people. The question here is, it's all investment drives activity and activity drives people. And what we see currently happening is the investment is not going in fast enough to actually drive the activity in the people. And what I mean is, we're ramping oil and gas down faster than what was predicted and for whatever reason. We also don't do the wind sector fast enough, and therefore we don't see the projects coming through and activity coming through. So at the moment, depending on what scenario we're in, we might not actually have fewer jobs than we currently have. And that's a different issue than what you heard this morning on skills. It's a job issue, not a skills issue. If we go for the increase and we are delivering the ambition set out by UK government and by Scottish government, and we need 50% more people, then we have exactly, as my colleagues outlined, the issue we need to deal with. Where's the workforce come from and how do we skill it up? It's a lovely problem to have because we actually have a huge amount of investment going in the industry, and we have actually a thriving Scotland because quite a lot of jobs will be here. But it is collectively, we first have to create that situation that we have the investment activity to happen, and that is currently not on track.
It's interesting. It's a problem we want to have and then to tackle. But your report also talks about how that workforce will be very different. It states that a new workforce model will emerge with future jobs concentrated around key energy clusters across the UK. There will be a more transient workforce resulting in people moving from project to project across the country. So that flexibility will bring its own challenges. What are the implications of that change in workforce for the northeast of Scotland?
Yeah, so we looked at that. And so if you think about the northeast of Scotland, I'm sure everybody's been there and know that, it is predominantly what we call an OPEX workforce. It's a workforce that operates platforms, operate pipelines, operate terminals. But the future isn't about operating. The future is about building new things, new wind farms, new hydrogen facilities, new carbon capture and storage facilities. So the workforce we need predominantly is actually building these new activities and then operating. But we need far fewer people to operate a wind farm, as you heard this morning, than we need oil and gas platforms, far fewer to operate hydrogen than we need oil and gas. So we see this workforce coming in, being far more transient, going from project to project around the country. So they might build the Acorn facility in northeast of Scotland, and we might go to Teesside, do the next thing. So they will be far more transient. So the workforce is going to be quite different. So at the moment, we see 4 out of 5 people work in oil and gas at this point in time in the offshore energy industry. By the back end of the decade, if we meet the ambitions set out by the Scottish government and by UK government, we potentially see 3 out of 5 people working in the renewables. So there's a whole shift happening, a far more localized, far more transient workforce, far more focused on doing capital activity rather than OPEX activity. That is just not just a shift in skills, it's a fundamental shift in jobs, place, and what people are going to do. And then, of course, the big overlay is how much of it gets done by UK workforce in the UK, because a lot of these skills are going to be coming in from overseas in to do a task and disappear again. And our opportunity collectively here is to create that kind of UK-based, UK workforce to make sure we have the skills and capabilities here. And that's what these reports are aimed at.
But that must bring with it a huge threat to the need for or the delivery of a just transition if you have a workforce that could come and go, presumably, potentially on lower incomes than they are at the moment in the oil and gas industry, and that will have a big impact on the northeast of Scotland.
Yeah, absolutely, because I said before, you know, one in five of the jobs, one in three, including induced jobs in the north of Scotland, if we don't get it right and the money doesn't go in, we see a big outflow of skills and capabilities there. It's not a transition of people to go to something else. They will just move somewhere else, right? So it isn't they will go where the jobs are because they have mortgages to pay, bills to pay. They will go somewhere else. And what we see is an economic impact in the northeast of Scotland if we don't get this right.
I'm sure we could talk for hours on this, but my convener will probably stop me doing so, so I'll move on.
Thank you. Evelyn Tweed, to be followed by Kim Stewart.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, panel. Just to build on some of the things that Colin has been asking about, what about reskilling, upskilling of the workers in the area? Is enough being done? Can we do it better? What's the panel's thoughts on where we go with this? Because obviously, if we have this huge skills gap, it's obviously there's a lot of opportunity there for the future. But how do we support the workers in the area that, to make sure we get this right?
Hello. Maggie, again, I think the North East has been fortunate because it has received a significant amount of investment from the Just Transition Fund. So the NESA development, we're working with the college and the universities and Maggie's team around looking at the curriculum there. Maggie described how the facility was going to be open in evenings and weekends, and that's something I think we have to look at colleges, not just in the North East, but across Scotland. We've got a fantastic college estate, but all too often it's maybe open one night a week, two nights. Very seldom is it available at weekends, and that's when people are in jobs and want to try and do something different if it can change. I touched on things like the boot camp model from down south, and that's available to companies to access, to actually put their own staff on, and they can get a discounted rate on that. If you're unemployed and looking to move into a sector, that's free, and they retain their benefits while they're on that. And I think initially, myself and others in Scotland were probably quite sceptical about them, but they're much more targeted now at specific areas of need, and they've been used to good effect. We don't have things like career development loans, which I think is a kind of gap in the market. So you either get people who have been made redundant, as John referenced this morning, either using redundancy, or I've seen people putting stuff on credit cards to try and get back into employment. And you want to avoid that. You want to give, going back to Just Transition, give people the right type of support. And the Just Transition commissioned in their initial report, they talked about a skills guarantee. There's not been any due diligence done in that. So what's the scale of the market for that? So in my head, with a big impact to somebody who'd been made unemployed at Longannet, 5 years ago, but never get back into employment, but they qualify for a guarantee. And what's in that guarantee? Is it a skills allowance? Is it careers guidance? What's in it? So I think we need to be mindful that if we make statements, then we follow up and actually say that this is something that's tangible. And because it's been discussed in Parliament, there's not been any further development activity on it. So we need to bring some degree of agility into the system. And we need to get a bit more flexibility, as NESA has done, into the kind of core offerings from colleges and universities.
Can I make a few comments? Just, yes. We looked at who is the future workforce in 2030. It actually is remarkable. It's actually us, just 7 years older, right? So there's a vast majority of people in the industry is just us and with more experience. So we see an element around upskilling and right-skilling the existing workforce, which is not a trivial matter. And then there's, of course, the new skilling of the new people coming in, which is really clear. But what the main element we need to have is a very agile demand forecasting system, because the better you are at forecasting your demand, the more you can get the supply side to work around what colleges, universities, Skills Development Scotland, Scottish Enterprise needs to do. So we're working very hard around as industry as how do we make sure we're really clear around what the demand picture looks like, both on existing workforce, transferability of the workforce, so how many people you need in oil and gas, how many people you need in wind, and what kind of nature of people, so you can get the demand sector, so the supply sector to work. Now, my other role is being the chair of the National Energy Skills Accelerator, what Lauren has talked about and Maggie talked about this morning. And we set up NESA as a specific response to deal with this? So at scale, how do you help your existing workforce to swap over? Now, we're 2 years in. We got some money from the Just Transition Fund earlier this year, and we already have over more than 600 people going to the programs, and hopefully in a few months' time, that number is substantially higher. So it is actually, there's a huge demand for skilling, upskilling the existing workforce, but people need clarity, upskilling for what? Yeah, and that's something what we are now saying is with the clear demand picture, what do you need to do? And there's a real issue on timing, because some of the wind sector isn't ready at scale yet to take lots of people in. And how do you make sure, what point in time do you get people ready, right skilled for the wind sector, where you need them in 4 or 5 years' time? There's no point skilling them at scale now if you need them in years to come. So we are matching supply and demand in a far smarter way than we probably have ever done before.
Okay. Thank you. Kevin Stewart, to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. And my first question will be for Mr. McGuinness, who will have heard Mr. Borland talk about the skills passport. Now, I recognise that you don't have complete management over this, Mr. McGuinness, but where are the blockages in getting this right for people?
Thanks. I think this is a challenging project. So it's a project that's been funded, £5 million award from the Scottish Government's energy team to Opito, who manage the skills component of the North Sea Transition Deal. Good collaboration, I think, across a number of partners, organisations like ECITB, and I'm particularly connected to them. They have an initiative called Connective Competence, which will come into that framework of the Energy Skills Passport, as would Opito's. I think any industry that I've worked in where they've, and not even trying to harmonise, they're just trying to get recognition of the other organisations' qualifications and certification, is challenging, because what you're doing is going into what is a bit of a cash cow for organisations. And for Global Wind Organisation, this doesn't affect the UK market. This would potentially compromise what they do in a global market. They're Danish, they operate globally, as do Opito. They operate around the world. So it's always contentious when you're trying to do something of this nature, but the programme has been well funded. It was supported by Ernst & Young through a competitive tender. As John reported, there was a...
So basically, I get all of that. Who needs their heads knocked together to get this show on the road, basically?
I think in at the launch event, Mr. Matheson knocked heads together. He said they would lock people in the room and buy them pizzas until they came to an agreement.
I wouldn't be buying the pizza.
And I would, aye. There was strong ministerial engagement at that early stage. I've tried to pick up with Opito and get some, because there'll be sensitivities here and there'll be financial compromises across organisations. So I will take it back to Opito. One of my colleagues is in a consultative group, but we weren't involved in a meeting in London last week, so 2 weeks ago, so it would be unfair for me to comment on that, but I will pick up as a matter of urgency and come back.
I think that would be very useful, and it may, I think it would be really required that you can write back to the committee. Maybe Opito can write to the committee as well, convener. We can write to them to find out what the blockages actually are, because that would be withdrawing the pizza, basically.
John indicated there is a further meeting planned 18th of January. It would be good to understand what's happening between now and then, and what changes the dynamics.
Maybe the folk who will be meeting on the 18th of January will have taken cognizance of what's been said today. I want to move on, convener, because we have heard around about the differences or the perceived differences and how jobs will operate in this new future. Professor Deleu talked about a much more transient workforce. Would it be fair to say that there is already a pretty transient workforce in the northeast of Scotland? Aberdeen has operated as a global city, and folk have come in, folk have gone, Aberdonians have moved elsewhere and come back. So Is that transience maybe less of a challenge for Aberdeen in the northeast of Scotland than it would be if that was taking place elsewhere?
I think the answer is it's already there. I've been in the industry all my life, right? So I spend most of my time in the operator and developer community. So yes, it is a very transient workforce. But what I mean is new level of transience is that we're going to not create an oil and gas workforce or wind workforce. We're going to create an energy workforce.
Yeah.
And so there will be multi-energy factors. So we have loads. I mean, most of the people actually work in the supply chain, right? The operator and developer community only have typically around 10% of the people work there. 90% work in the supply chain. And the supply chain is already servicing multiple clients across the energy spectrum, either here in the UK or overseas. And some of these tasks are hugely transient. Again, the work we do, we see 90% have medium to high transferability between one sector and the other. So the putting a pipeline down or an electricity cable down, big electricity cable, it's the same technology. Putting footings down for a wind farm or footings down for an oil and gas platform, it's the same thing. So we see actually it being very transient for the workforce, not just in the type of work, but also the place they work, and particularly with the ability now to work from anywhere, actually, you know, it becomes a far more flexible system as we see it. But what we mean is more transient. It is not just the nature of energy, it's also place-based, but the way we're going to work is also going to be different.
Sure. You talked of flexibility there, and I think, you know, that's another key aspect of the shift that we need to make. Now, having been at a Shell event on Friday, specifically for girls in energy, with 18 schools from across the northeast represented, speaking to some of the young women there, they recognise themselves now that, you know, the fields that they want to enter, they're going to have to be much more flexible in that work in the future. So talking to one lass who wants to be a mechanical engineer, she recognises that there will be flexibility, there will have to be flexibility in terms of her working life, even though she wants to remain as a mechanical engineer. It seems, though, that we have got some impediments at this moment in time in terms of those flexibilities, including getting the likes of this passport. In your opinion, you know, the workforce, the future workforce, recognises that there needs to be flexibility. Is it the case that some of the trade bodies are not accepting that there needs to be that flexibility? And if they don't, they could cause a real problem in terms of us reaching our ambitions.
Yeah, I can't talk about it on behalf of the trade bodies. That's, you need to ask them. But what we need is a truly flexible, transferable workforce that we need to do. And I think the passport is important, but let's not get hung up. The passport is not for everybody, right? Mm. If you're an HR professional or you're a finance professional or you're a procurement professional, you can move easily between the sectors without a passport, right? It is mainly for the people on operational sites who need to make sure there's a competency framework and assurance that they can do the job. If you look at the future of jobs, that's only a percentage of the roles we really have. Because the work we have done, if you look where the jobs are, top five job families, so job families, some of the similar like jobs, like operations, engineering, technicians, projects, and supply chain, they make up 70% of the future jobs we need. Right? So it's kind of interesting around, if you think about the criticality of jobs in the future, what do we need to train people for? Will they all need a passport? No. But do we need to have a transient workforce? Yes. But if you're a technician, we already know you can actually move across fairly quickly. If you're supply chain, you can move across fairly quickly. This is supply chain management rather than being in the supply chain. So when you look at the nature of work, and you work your way backwards and saying, okay, what do we need to do? That's why we need the integrated plan, which is what I've talked about, and I fully agree with, an integrated coordinated plan. So we line it all up for success. That's what we really need. And that gives a clarity back to the workforce and the young people coming into the work. I see through the university, there's lots of enthusiasm for joining the energy industry, but people just want to know, what is the jobs going to be? How exciting is it going to be? What difference can I make?
I wonder if I could turn to Suzanne, convener, and talk and ask her around about flexibilities within companies themselves and how flexible they are in terms of change. Now, you talked around about, you know, there is the fear of, you know, a year's without going without contracts, but are there folks who are stuck, who are not looking at this future the way that they should be, and, you know, diversifying? And what are you, other agencies, doing to try and get them to see the light around about that diversification?
I think in the Northeast, that situation is far less prevalent than it is in the rest of Scotland, because the energy sector is well understood, and the man in the street has a good appreciation of how important it is and how important the transition is. So that translates then to companies as well. Across the company base, there just aren't enough ambitious manufacturing and engineering businesses to satisfy the supply chain needs that are going to come. There just aren't enough of those companies. They aren't necessarily big enough, and they don't employ enough people. So how we are going about this, and so in terms of the question about flexibility, obviously it varies enormously, but like any small business, you know, they're looking 1, 2, 3 years ahead at most, and they have to sustain the business, and there are a lot of pressures, a lot of competing pressures. So if they've got an oil and gas contract, for example, that's very profitable, and they can see it extending out 2 or 3 years, then quite understandably, that will be their main focus. Now, when you start to get into larger businesses, then they have more capability to look more strategically long term. What our role is to try and address that, what in old-fashioned economic development language would be information gap. So to address some of the concerns that this community of supply chain companies have and make sure that they're aware of what the opportunities are. And as I was saying earlier, looking at what capability they have now and what markets that could serve now domestically and also internationally, and how we can help them make the right strategic choices and also finance those strategic choices. And that includes the workforce. So I think there are a growing number of businesses who, in the supply chain, who do see what the opportunity, or who are starting to see, but they're battling, they're sort of juggling the different factors, the need at hand factors about retention of staff and delivering contracts now, and the uncertainty, that word came up this morning as well, the uncertainty about the renewables markets and when that's going to actually happen, and balancing out when you upskill, when you recruit staff, as against when you're going to get the contracts. One last point I would just make is that the skills that are needed in businesses of the future in the supply chain, I'm talking about manufacturing, fabrication, engineering, these kind of skills, they will be different because much of the equipment now, there's an image, we talked about young people earlier, women, there might be an image of a kind of greasy, dirty engineering type environment. And increasingly, as I'm sure we all know, the skills that are needed are programming skills, as well as knowing how to run the machinery, but it's also understanding software and knowing how to do that. So there are different skill sets that are going to be needed, and those skill sets are needed across all industries. So again, these engineering companies are competing for the same people coming through the system with that kind of range of skills that are needed in a modern manufacturing environment.
So you've got finite resources, as we all have finite resources. You talked of that information gap. One of the things which I hear quite regularly is, you know, folk not being able to access help and support from Scottish Enterprise, from others. I think it was Ms. McGinley earlier that talked about bringing SNIB in a roadshow situation. I think she mentioned Scottish Enterprise. Do you think that it would be advantageous, or I'll put it another way, could you, with other partners, including SNIB and others, regularly run roadshows over the next while in Aberdeen and the North East to help companies plug that information gap and to help them secure their futures? Because I do think you know, that often one of the difficulties that is faced is you know, that support not quite being there. And I'll turn that in its head because, you know, credit where credit's due, I actually know of another company who has had Scottish Enterprise support in recent times, which has grown very, very quickly indeed. And I won't mention them because I've not got the permission to do so. We've grown very, very quickly indeed because of sound advice, basically. Not a huge amount of financial support, but sound advice.
So to answer that question directly, yes, we absolutely can and are. So that is are running events. Now, the bit about collaboration, we heard about a lot this morning. Scottish Enterprise, in fact, none of us should be doing these things on our own, because it just becomes very confusing for businesses. It's all very, we all know about the crowded landscape and who do you go to. So we are really keen to work in partnership on this. So we work in partnership with ETZ. We work in partnership with Scottish Renewables, with Scottish Engineering, with the cluster organisations, with Highlands and Islands Enterprise and SOSI as well. It is absolutely critical that we do that. With SNIB, and because those organisations are also taking that message out. So we are doing that in partnership. We do it, we support them. So, for example, when ETZ run a series of masterclasses, we attend and we support that work, and vice versa. So but we absolutely will be doing more. And we have to make our resource. This is a priority for Scottish Enterprise, the energy sector, and strengthening the supply chain is absolutely a priority for us. The other component is, of course, inward investment, which we're also responsible for, and we have had some recent successes in that, which also strengthens and plugs gaps in the supply chain. But that, as well as supporting those inward investors when they come in, we need to make sure that their purchasing is also their supply chain, their local supply chain is strengthened, and that they're finding what they need in the local market, and that we're working with those businesses. So there's multiple ways into this, but in short, yes, absolutely. Doing roadshows in the North East is absolutely something we're doing and we'll be doing more of.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Could I ask witnesses and MSPs to keep the questions and answers as concise as possible? We are pressed a bit for time now this morning. Colin Beattie to be followed by Brian Whittle.
Thank you. For those of you that were present during the last panel, the questions I asked there, I didn't really get a very definitive response. So I'm hoping it will get better here. We've talked about the energy sector and the anticipation that people will transition from jobs in the oil and gas into renewables, although in recent times, certainly according to the evidence we've received, it's not been as quick or at a volume that was expected. Looking specifically at other skills and industries and looking at construction, for example, retrofitting the built environment. Research from the Construction Industry Training Board estimates that to meet zero targets, there's a need for 4,600 project managers, as well as 4,300 plumbers and HVAC workers by 2028, which isn't long. Now, we know from other evidence we've taken that figures, for example, for maintenance of heat pumps, maintenance of solar panels and all that, we saw a figure of 30,000 engineers needed for that. Now, looking at the skills pipeline that's been set up, does it have the capacity to deliver this volume in the time scales that people are looking at? And secondly, do the people exist? In other words, physically, there seems to be shortages in almost every sector. So how are we going to get these people? Are we going to buy them in from elsewhere, in which case we have a price issue on scarcity? Perhaps, Gordon, I can ask you to come in.
First of all, we need, I think, additional investment in apprenticeship frameworks. The ones that you're touching on are traditionally modern apprentices with a 3 to 4 year life cycle. So prior to COVID, we were probably 30,000 apprentices. Last year, this year, about 25,500. So we need greater investment into that space. some of this, I think, it reminds me of things like the kind of combined effort we had to make around early living and childcare to meet the government's new offer for increased cost. And that's where government were very clear on what SDS had to do through the apprenticeship programmes, but also very clear with the college estate what they expected SFC to deliver. And we delivered 10,000 additional people within the 2 or 3 year period required to allow government to fulfil that childcare offer. And it's a national type effort I think we need in some of these areas. To myself, if we're looking at going to net zero, the two disciplines you need more of are electricians and plumbers, and it's a bit of a no-brainer. I know of a company, they're one of the leading retrofitters, AC White, from Barrhead. They lost some of their international workers. They've been very creative in terms of setting up academies with some of the local FE colleges, but they do struggle to get the numbers through the door to fulfil the contracts that they have, and they are one of the leading contractors for kind of social rented housing to bring the housing up to a relative standard. So there is a challenge here, and I think we need to understand if we are making big investments in things like housing standards and from an infrastructure commission, we also need to think about we need the people to build and also maintain these facilities.
So there is capacity or there isn't capacity within the pipeline?
There's capacity if you get the financial resource to apply to it.
So there's not capacity because you need more money?
Yeah, that'd be my, yep. Conclusion.
So this can't be delivered without more money?
Well, I think if you need more apprentices and you need resource to fund apprentices, then we're going to struggle to deliver it unless we can increase apprenticeship numbers significantly. An example I gave was the last time it was a combined effort around early learning and childcare where there was additional resource brought in to meet that need.
So if you get the resources, can you find the people?
Well, those disciplines, right, there's never a shortage. If I look at SELECT and the Scottish Electoral Charitable Training Trust, there's never a shortage of applicants for electrical apprenticeships, or I would suggest plumbing. So yeah, I'll not say you meet those needs easily, but there's never been a shortage. But we need to start with having the resource to get the commitment to bring people into the sector.
Almost every sector of industry is talking about lack of resources,
yep.
Lack of physical bodies.
That's a consequence of Brexit. It's a consequence of our demographic profile in terms of the ageing workforce that we have. So you don't just need to think about growth. You need to think about replacement demand. And that's some of the challenges that people at BAA Systems have saw in the Clyde. They recruited 192 apprentices this year, because they know in the future workforce what they've got to do, so they're investing £12 million in a new academy. Now, they're fortunate as a company that they've got the resource to do that, but if you've got people to do a skilled job, then we need to skill them appropriately.
Suzanne.
If I can ask the other panel witnesses to be brief in reply to this question, as Gordon's covered a lot of the issues from SDS. Thank you.
Yeah, I don't feel I could add much to that, really, I'd agree.
I'm going to be very brief. I don't know the specific thing on the sector you mentioned, but there's one thing I know. I'm a member of the Green Job Delivery Work Group for the UK government. And there's a really interesting question, because it's not just Scottish, it's a UK question as well. If you don't have the people and you don't deliver targets, maybe you change the narrative. And the narrative might be, what do you prioritise? You know, because there's a sequence of things you can do. Yeah. So insulating people's homes is really high up there. Retrofitting is high. But there are certain things you might say, what is the political choice you make? What goes first? And how do we prioritise? Because then you can align your workforce to your needs.
Okay. Thank you. Brian Whittle will be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you. Good morning to the panel. I think my questions have changed several times over the last 5 minutes listening to what you've been saying. But I think one question, we understand the opportunities that, you know, the renewable technologies, you know, bring to not just to the North East but to Scotland. I think though that and also I'm aware of so much innovation and really blue sky thinking that's going on here. It's a very exciting time to watch that innovation. But are we as are our governments, UK and Scottish governments, doing enough to support that innovation, to develop that innovation, to make sure that we are at the forefront of that, to make sure that we have that, that commercial success that will then, as my colleague Colin Smith's questioning, will lead to this increase in you know job requirement where we have to I'd rather be looking for people to come into jobs than have too many people. I'll ask you first, Professor, if I could.
Right. Let me answer the question maybe through a different lens. It's the competitive framework, right? Mm-hmm. Let me give you what the competitors are doing, so you know what Scotland needs to be able to catch up. Let's start on China. China has more solar installed and make more solar than the rest of the world combined. China has more wind than the next seven nations combined. Okay, that's China. The US just put in place the Inflation Reduction Act, over $300 billion, a large part about making energy transition work and subsidizing activity. Europe has the Green Deal. Yeah? So that is our competitive framework and what's playing out. If Scotland wants to win this game, wants to get the best resources, the innovation, it wants to get the workforce, and they want to get the attention, we're going to have to do something with this compete. Now, we either do that, we do it faster, smarter, better, greener, whatever way we're going to do it, but we're going to have to put something in place to attract it, because although we have the ambition, it doesn't mean that we're going to get the supply chain and workforce to come here, because the competition is brutal at the moment. So I think innovation is a big lever, because we've got a track record, but don't underestimate the capacity we have in like hubs like Aberdeen and northeast of Scotland. We have a unique combination. It doesn't exist anywhere else of supply chain, operators, universities, colleges, the whole ecosystems exist. That this need to be primed with clear policy, clear plan, clear money to make it happen. So I think we have everything in place. Innovation is part of it, but the competition is pretty robust and getting even tougher.
Yeah, I could find the mind come away with a phrase that said the only competitive advantage we have is learning faster than our competitors.
Agility.
So, yep. You know, so I think so, with that in mind, Suzanne, in terms of what SE are doing just now, how do we maintain that advantage? I think we're charging ahead as far as I can see in terms of offshore wind or onshore wind. And as I talked about this morning, I'm a massive green hydrogen fan. So, and I think we're behind the curve with that. We're behind the curve probably in carbon capture, potentially in heat. How do we bring all that into the just transition at pace?
Internationally, Scotland is one of the areas of the world, because of what's happened in the northeast, that has an international global reputation for being able to compete in the global energy sector. So as Paul just said, we have that right from the start. We also have great resources right across Scotland. A lot of what's happening in the northeast that we heard about this morning, I would really like to see happen in other parts of Scotland, so it could be spread, some of the resources that we have, or at the very least make sure that companies in the rest of Scotland understand what's available, for example, through the ORE catapult for floating offshore wind. In terms of hydrogen, the North East is already... I think there's a mindset in the North East which is quite innovative of itself and quite open, quite global mindset because of its history and legacy of the oil and gas sector. So I think that you see that in hydrogen. There's the biggest heat network in Scotland. It's in the area. The hydrogen production green hydrogen production will kick off, I think, in 2 years or 2025. That will fuel 25 buses there. Again, that's innovative. We are seeing real... When we do work on hydrogen, we have 111 projects that we are working with just now throughout Scotland on hydrogen. 29 of them are in the northeast. There's a spread, but the northeast absolutely plays a part. Now, those projects are all at different stages of development, and on hydrogen in particular, so it's probably a different subject, but what we're focusing on in Scottish Enterprise in terms of the conversations we're having and the work we're doing is matching the off-taker, because that's the key to it. If you look at the whisky, the decarbonisation of the whisky industry using hydrogen, it's that marriage, the off-taker and the production, that's what needs to come together. We are seeing pockets of that coming together in the northeast, and I do think there's the right mindset. So in terms of the innovation side, I absolutely concur. It's incredibly important. Completely agree about global competitiveness. We are perceived to have competitive edge in floating offshore wind, And that, so that's a potential area where we could distinguish ourselves. And but we do need to make sure that we're making the progress. And that starts from academic institutes. So what we're doing in Scottish Enterprise is focusing on encouraging, which happens in the Northeast, but throughout Scotland, encouraging research projects at academic institutions, that they turn into spin-outs, that we make sure through our work and investment and through the work of SNIB and others that these projects are funded into companies, into scalable companies, and that we're working with them throughout the journey. And then at the other end of the market, working with developers and the very large companies in terms of how they're going to get their projects off the ground and develop their supply chains, and looking at the technology gaps that they have and how we might convene different parties to work with them. The last thing I'd say, we're still part of Horizon Europe, so also working with other companies and SMEs and organisations across Europe in partnering up on energy-related innovation projects is also part of what we're doing and what we're doing more of.
Thank you. Where I do agree for sure is you need to develop the marketplace. If you develop the marketplace, then business will innovate to supply that marketplace. I think that, you know, for me, that's where we're behind. But in the short, because I've got short time, I'll come to you, Gordon, around sort of the long-term strategy and planning in terms of delivery of workforce. And I asked this question earlier on, because I think the major untapped workforce is women into STEM. And forever we talk about that, and that is a huge potential. And I'm not sure I've quite got an answer to that. So there's a couple of things here. One, how do we move that dial? Because that's a workforce we require. And the other thing I was really interested in was this need to invest in education. And the education I heard there was you know, colleges opening at night. What a great innovation that is. But that will cost money. So are we really, really, to deliver on our targets, would you agree with me we need to invest more into that sort of education system that allows that transition to happen? Easy questions.
Yeah, I don't think there's any. When I speak to employers, they're very aware of that need to diversify the workforce. When you asked the question earlier on, I was checking back the STEM strategy, which was published 2017, and it's been reviewed 3 times. And hand in heart, I don't think we've moved the dial. So we spend a lot of money in STEM. And as we've heard, also heard this morning, we get a lot of companies that want to invest in STEM. I just don't know if we're investing in the right things. So a takeaway for me today is to go back and look at that for the last evaluation of the STEM strategy. It was like Shirley Ann Somerville that introduced the original strategy. But I don't think it's necessarily got the momentum in government. And okay, there's a lot of different things happening in education. But it's an area that we need to make a difference on and improve the quality experience, not just for girls, but for everybody, because too often it's episodic. It's a one-off, one and done, and young people will enjoy it, but it doesn't make that longer-term impact. So I'll go away from today and have a look at the work that's been done through the strategy.
Okay, thank you. I'll leave it there.
Okay, thank you. Gordon MacDonald will be followed by Murdo Fraser.
Thanks very much, convener. We already have the energy hub in Aberdeen in the northeast, with we've already touched upon oil and gas, offshore wind and wave technology, etc. But I wanted to continue the questions about hydrogen. Now, Paul, you mentioned earlier on that there was $200 billion of investment, 100 already been placed, and looking at where some of that $100 billion has been spent, it's been spent in places like China, America, Chile, Germany. No mention of the UK. The top 10 producers of green hydrogen are forecast to be those countries I've mentioned, but also Morocco, Canada, Egypt. Again, no mention of the UK. So how attractive is Scotland and indeed the UK to for green hydrogen investors to come to Scotland?
Yeah, so it's quite interesting when we looked at where the money goes, right? Again, if you follow the money, you can get a flavour of what needs to be done because it drives activity. Hydrogen is a relatively modest part of that $200 billion. Right. This decade, it will go bigger. Okay. And the reason is the thing my colleagues already mentioned. For hydrogen, for wind, it's easy, right? You get the electrons, and you can put them into the electricity system and do something with it. Yeah. for hydrogen, there is no natural market to go to, right? So investors go like, I need to develop both supply and demand. I need to do it all. So you can do that at the micro scale. So you can, it's called this enterprise project being worked on. But if you want to do it at large scale, you need to have a large market, either in the UK or an export market, or what we call a conversion market. You produce hydrogen and you do something else with it on a local basis. And that is going to take time. Yeah? And that's why I think where the hydrogen one is, if you want to go for green hydrogen, you need to have the wind first. So you develop the wind farms first to get the green hydrogen. You need to have excess wind to do it. And that's going to take time. That's why we see if it's hydrogen at scale, it's going to be next decade rather than this decade. But that doesn't mean you can't start planning for it and plant the seeds for it to make it happen. But if we want to win in hydrogen in Scotland, we need to be really clear that we have real good access to cheap wind. Mm-hmm. And have a real mechanism what we do in hydrogen. The market in Scotland is probably not big enough, so you need to have export elements coming in, either to pipelines or to other products or to whatever mechanism you want to have. I think that's key that we have an integrated hydrogen plan. And the hydrogen strategy is a good starting point, but it's not going to get us there. And I think we need a far more integrated plan that says, actually, we need to create a market. So you might go for microgreen, not the projects, called enterprise work, microgreen, small, a small market to go with it. Potentially have blue as the bridge to big green. So you basically can build take blue hydrogen, make it from fossil fuels, but at least create a market for it. And then you have when the wind is there, you're going to have large green hydrogen to fill the marketplace. So I think there's a plan probably required to think about it in that way. What is a logical structure to actually start small and build very rapidly? Now, remember, the competition doesn't stand still, right? If we're sitting in Germany at the moment, you have a completely different conversation. They're looking for 10 gigawatts of hydrogen by 2030, half imported, right? So there's a very different market here. And again, if we want to play a Scotland in that market, we need to be export ready, production ready, capability ready to do that. We're not.
So we are already in a situation where we produce more electricity than we can use in Scotland, so we have that capability to export that electricity or to use it for hydrogen production. So we're already one step ahead in the sense we have that surplus. Yep. Right? So, you know, there was mention earlier that there was a potential to export to Germany. I think it was an announcement it was Scottish Government, the High Line project. How do we get investors interested, given that we have the energy hub, we have the excess of electricity generated from wind, and we have a potential project in that we could export hydrogen to Germany in liquid form?
In my previous life, I was working for the operator and developer community. What you look for is certainty. If there's a guaranteed contract to take hydrogen from one place to another place, backed up by contract, you'll invest. At the moment, what we can't do, we haven't got that investor confidence to build a pipeline, get the volume, get it all done, because it's such an immature market. Mm-hmm. So I think we have to develop the market, build the confidence that is out there, investors will follow. Now, there is a big demand. Europe is a huge demand area, so we have a demand on our doorstep. Mm-hmm. This needs an integrated plan, and it's already happening, right? The Net Zero Technology Centre is looking at the hydrogen backbone, the connection to Germany, there's an MOU being signed, so it's already starting. But yeah, it might need a bit of extra effort to get it over the line and build the confidence for the market.
Okay. Suzanne, you said earlier that we need certainty and a clear roadmap in order to get the investment we require. Is there anything else that either the Scottish Government or the UK Government has to do in order that we can get to the point that Paul's describing?
I think the clarity of vision extending out over parliamentary terms would be ideal. And I think that because this is not a five-year horizon, it's a 20-year horizon, and the payback, because it's to build a pipeline from Scotland into Europe, if there was a strong vision and roadmap to do that, I think we could it would attract the funding for it, if that was the kind of certain. So I think it's having that clarity. We talked earlier, the panel talked about communication, and I think it's the clarity of vision and the message that's going out globally that Scotland is actually serious about doing this, and we are going to be doing this, and I think the rest can fall. So it needs to be more than an ambition. It does need to have a kind of roadmap. I've used that word a few times, but a roadmap towards actually getting that, and I think that collectively that's within our reach. I think it's something that we can do, but it does need clarity of ambition, vision, and a lot of collaboration to get agreement behind that. The opportunities for hydrogen, as Paula said, are considerable. In terms of Germany and Holland, that's where we have most interest in Scotland. We have had many visits from these markets to Scotland to look around and hosted many such trips. But they're also looking at many other markets, so it's very competitive. So in Scottish Enterprise, we're looking at bolstering our resources out in Germany to form and maintain the relationships with the right parties, both in the private and the public sector, around the import of hydrogen from Scotland into Germany. So we are looking at taking steps like that, but we do need to do more and think bigger, really, to get this off the ground.
Okay. And Gordon, in order to achieve this ambitious project that would deliver for Scotland, what additional skills do we need, and what do you guys need for certainty?
The kind of skills group that works off a hydrogen action plan actually met in Aberdeen, I think, last week. And I think initially they believe the skills that we have meet that initial period of growth. The demands will come further 3-4 years down the line. It was the kind of general, I don't know if you participated in that discussion, it was Chris Brodie, my colleague, that was up at that session. And I think if you go back to the session we had at Grangemouth, or in here with Grangemouth, the trade union leader at that time, in terms of the site, he didn't see, in terms of the process engineering, significant differences in terms of what they did at Grangemouth and then how they would handle the hydrogen. So I think in the short term, the group that met last week were confident that they had the kind of skill sets required.
Thank you.
Thank you.
A quick supplementary.
Thank you. Yeah, I do have an interest in green hydrogen. the talk just now is about this idea of building a pipeline across to Germany, which is obviously hugely exciting. Surely that doesn't have to be the first step. We've got the capability of deep water ports at Hunterston, Aberdeen last week. Why are we not focusing on that as a step before we get to to deliver that marketplace before we get to the building of that pipeline? Because that's a much quicker option, surely.
No, we absolutely are. But to build that capability, we'd need long-term planning. It wouldn't, obviously, state in the obvious, but it wouldn't happen overnight. So, but no, we absolutely are focused on all the, as I say, we've got 111 projects and they're all different sizes and stages. It is a nascent industry, and when I attend conferences about hydrogen, this is a common situation across many countries, that they're not getting to final investment decisions, they're not getting over the line on the projects, and it is often because, just what we've said earlier, about the producers having to satisfy both the production and the demand side. Mm. And that's why I think there's more that we can do collectively around the demand side, the off-taker side. And I think it is through, I do agree that it is through these kind of smaller projects that we'll start to build our understanding and capability in this. The big emitters in Scotland, like the Grangemouth area, are a really good place to start because there's an awful lot of willingness and drive to find solutions there. So those offer us a big potential to start in those type of geographies, I think, and the North East.
If I can add to it, I mean, I think pipeline is one thing, right? Again, I said you started microgreen and blue, and you start with more local projects, smaller projects. You have to start developing and supply and demand side and the market. So it will take a bit of time. You know, number one would not be build a pipeline. I mean, I don't think that's happening. But if you think about how the oil and gas industry developed across UK and the EU, look at the pipe system that was in the 1970s and look what happened for 50 years later. There's a network of integrated pipes and pipelines all across Europe, right? And I think we're going to see a similar one happening for the new energies, be it and hydrogen being part of it, where we see it for industrial use coming up. So it is part of a wider infrastructure play in Europe, and that's the thing. If we need to connect to that as the Scotland or UK, I think it's a perfectly sensible thing to do.
Thank you.
Myrtle Fraser, followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Convener. I appreciate time is a bit short, so I'm just going to ask one question, if I can, about the Just Transition Fund. which we haven't really touched on yet. I just want to get your view on that. To what extent do you think it's supporting innovation and the development of new technologies? And do you have any view on the way the fund operates, with the Scottish National Investment Bank being the ones who are effectively the gatekeepers to the fund? Professor.
Shall I start? All right, okay, great. Thank you. I'll give you two examples we have been involved with, which is just Transition Fund, and then some observations about Fund Point Forward. So I break your question into two, that's all right. So we have been on the receiving end, first of all, of funding for the National Energy Skills Accelerator. And as the chair, we're very proud to continue to get some money, £1 million for it. We made great progress, which wouldn't have happened without the fund. So what we have done, the National Energy Skills Accelerator was set as, how do we make sure, when we know what the demand for the workforce is, how do we do the supply side to get the actual workforce trained? Since we got the monies only about 8 or 9 months ago, we already said we have over 600 people lined up to go to the program. We probably have more by the end of this year. They go to over 30 programs, half of them are brand new, because enabled by the fund. So it is, and we have a huge demand for people to kind of learn about the other energy sectors. So if you want a success story, that's a big one. But also, as Robert Gordon University, we got money for a digital innovation lab. And actually, we're using that for the northeast of Scotland, where we're mapping Aberdeen. We literally have a plane flying over, mapping Aberdeen to take the thermal imaging of Aberdeen and saying where is the heat in the place, and how do we actually think about how to help to retrofit Aberdeen to get to a net zero city. So again, a classic example of how we're using innovation money from the Just Transition Fund to change the place around and actually do real innovation of actually doing something around combining technology with our capability in our School of Architecture of how we build and the housing stock and the commercial stock in Aberdeen. So some cracking examples. What has been really good in the early days, of course, for the fund, as you well know, I think there's a bit more thinking required around, you know, what is the balance between capital activity and resource activity. You know, at the moment, a lot goes into capital rather than resource activity. It's quite hard to fund things like NESA to the fund. So I think that is helpful. I think it will be really clear around where the IP lies. So when the fund gets in there, can the IP lie as the originator rather than is it? I like to see multi-year funding rather than one-year funding. Now, I know that's difficult given the budgeting requirements, but actually it's really hard to have single-year funding and go like we can only do a project for a short duration. And I want them also to make sure it is also focused on a strategic nature. We have identified in our Making the Switch report the big things what need to happen to set the northeast of Scotland up for success. These need big strategic investment. Now, we need to be mindful the fund can only do so much, but actually, how do we balance between long-term strategic versus short-term nice-to-haves as well? And I think that's maybe what the next round the fund can take account of.
Thank you.
Well, Scottish Enterprise, we haven't accessed just transition funding, so I don't really have any direct experience of it.
Okay.
Just a kind of comment. Paul touched on it. For skills, most of the funding is allocated through capital resource, and really need more revenue resource just for training activities. So kind of common issue at present.
Yeah, so it's not helpful to you in your skills work?
No.
Yeah. Okay. All right, thank you.
Thank you very much. And good afternoon to the panel. Thank you for joining us. Just to expand on some of the conversations we've had around supply chain issues. Suzanne, earlier you talked about the challenges being much greater for SMEs than for others, and the margins, the flexibility, the agility, or the capacity to adapt are maybe slightly less for them. Can you just say a little bit more about where you see how you and Scottish Enterprise would want to see us, see the Scottish Government focus very, very clearly on support for supply chain within the energy sector, first off?
So I think it starts with kind of embracing of the energy sector and a kind of vision and for the energy sector, as we've talked about before, overall, to make the sector to recognise its importance to the Scottish economy, recognise the opportunity we have here in the North East, but also throughout Scotland, for the whole of Scotland to thrive in as we journey towards a net zero environment. So I think that is something that we are all trying to communicate and get across. And that impacts on, you were talking about women into STEM subjects. There's another figure that always stuck with me, that of all the students who go to university to study engineering, 50% of boys, or young men, sorry, end up working in engineering. Mm-hmm. 30% is the figure for women. Yeah. So there's a lot to be done, I think, in to communicate the attractiveness and the importance of the long-term importance and stability of the energy sector and the kind of varied, interesting, stimulating jobs. We've talked a lot about engineering, but beyond that, in the earlier section, we talked about everyone from lawyers to HR, from mm-hmm. environmental specialists, my goodness, we need those. So all these professional services as well are really important. So I think there's a kind of starting point, which is communicating how important the energy sector is and for it to be all inclusive, for it to be all embracing, including the transition from the oil and gas. I think we heard that this morning, rather than, because we know that the oil and gas sector struggles to recruit from young population in the northeast, sometimes because they don't want to join an environmentally damaging sector. Mm-hmm. So there is that. So if it's more about the energy sector and more inclusive, I think it could be portrayed as more attractive. In terms of coming down to the engineering and manufacturing supply side, I think from that point of view, again, that hasn't had much profile. It as much profile as it needs, in the sense of its importance. It's the backbone of Scottish manufacturing. Manufacturing, we have a fantastic heritage and a reputation globally, but have we let it dwindle a bit? Mm-hmm. And do we all need to get behind the manufacturing engineering sector?
What you're saying is helpful. Just on that, in terms of potentially supporting what might be perceived as a dwindling sector around manufacturing, is there something required about our work with infrastructure, with infrastructure projects? We heard earlier this morning about the importance of ports, for instance. But are there those places of industry or of manufacturing or fabrication that we aren't maybe looking at in a targeted enough way?
I think we are looking at them now. Okay. The government recently announced £500 million funding, and that will be, I would imagine, largely into the ports and harbours. We have the SIM process that was referenced earlier, and I think it's the 44 projects that are going to come through that. There will need to be some prioritisation within that. We need big marshalling space. We also need to recognise that because of the physical reality of different ports, some having deeper water, some being more mm-hmm. sheltered than others, that they will have a different part to play. One of the challenges we have with that in Scotland that other markets don't necessarily have is they're not state-owned here. They're privately owned and they're owned in different models. So it's not for the state to decide necessarily how all the ports are to be used, but it is for parts of the public sector and the private sector to collaborate and come to the best arrangement mm-hmm. for the whole of Scotland. There also need to be some pretty grown-up collaborations and decisions and agreements made around sequencing and using these precious resources next to ports, because they'll be used for the build-out at different times by different organisations. So, this, again, it comes back to this coordination, collaboration, some really visionary thinking about mm-hmm. how we're going to get all these parts to work. So the supply chain from that perspective is both hugely enabling and enhancing, but it also could be true that a big inward investor could effectively take up most of the space at a given port. Yep. And that's just the reality of it, because of the vast spaces these big pieces of kit need. Yeah. So that has to be recognised as well.
That's really helpful. Earlier you also mentioned the 1,000 companies that mm-hmm. Scottish Enterprises is wanting to mm-hmm. work with. How many of those are not in the energy sector?
So we've identified 2,700 that are supply chain companies who are not yet in the renewable energy sector or who are doing just a little bit. So that's our overall target group. And then we've kind of refined it down to about 1,000 that we're targeting today. And I don't know the figure of those that are in the northeast. I can certainly provide that. I don't know that off the top of my head, I'm sorry. But that's overall in Scotland, that 1,000 companies.
OK, no, thank you. Paul, I can see you wanting to come in on this as well. But just Suzanne, one last point for you around the non-energy supply chains. You've already spoken about some of the softer stuff needed around that, but are there things that we are missing? Are there things that we're not looking at? We've either in the industries and sectors that support the energy sector directly, but also sort of more indirect things like, you know, transport or other things that we're just not thinking about.
There's probably quite a lot around it. The types of businesses in the supply chain, not necessarily in the oil and gas sector, but the other types of companies work in quite tight margins. And one of the challenges, I'm not sure this is a soft factor, but one of the challenges is really for industry and working with industry on standardisation of components and products. Because in a world where there's a lot of innovation, what happens is a given developer, a different company, they have a bespoke solution for a bespoke situation, and then another company's doing the same. So having industry come together faster around standardisation of components and products and approaches used to solve different problems will help the supply chain, because then they've got the economies of scale because they're providing it to this company and this company. In terms of softer skills, things like, you know, transport and all that, that's a kind of wider conversation. And Gordon touched earlier about the very real situation on skills, which is the physical location of where people are and then where the new sites might be in more rural environments where there aren't enough people physically living there, there isn't enough housing. So there are quite a lot, and that's where quite a lot of other factors. And that's where, for example, in Scottish Enterprise on Inward Investment, we're working more with local authorities, for example, than on other projects, because some of these barriers are coming at, are raised by the overseas investors saying, yes, but if we put a site there, where are the people going to come from? Where do they live and how do they physically get? Especially in a sustainable world where we don't want everybody necessarily getting in their cars and driving 50 miles to work. So all of those factors are relevant.
No, thank you. That's helpful. Paul, coming to you, you talked earlier, you gave that very, very clear example of the heat mapping of the city and how that can, it's not directly in, well, it's not an energy generation activity, but it is broad, more broadly part of the that our trajectory towards net zero. Can you just say a little bit more about where you think the barriers are for supporting the non-energy work in supply chain issues specifically?
Can I just make a very quick comment on what I just heard on this one, right? Just on the supply chain, I mean, we need to separate between where does the money go, which we mapped out at 200 billion, where does it go, and what does it enable the money to be spent, right? So again, you know, because actually the spend is actually only in six key areas. And if we don't get the six key areas in Scotland, the money won't come here, right? So most of the ports and harbours isn't where most of the spend goes. It enables the spend to go to it. That is where, so it's more, we don't get sidetracked that is the only thing we need to do, because actually the areas like subsea and getting turbines done is equally probably far more important in terms of the volume of money being spent.
Right.
So just to want to make sure the point of the committee is clear on this one.
Yeah.
Just on the particular one around the supply chain for local activities. I think this is brand new, right? So what we've done here, what we're talking about, the Digital Innovation Lab we're doing at the Robert Gordon University, is brand new. And what we see happening is a whole huge of spin-offs coming out around where we can map a city and saying is, how do you get a city net zero? What are the key buildings you need to focus on first? What's the mechanism to do so? Working with the local councils to set it up. So there's a huge amount of opportunity, which is something we just need to now figure out of how we're going to do it. But we see there's a real potential to make this an exemplar of a fantastic project coming out of the Just Transition Fund. We're saying is actually this is going to make a real difference across how you make a place-based element. And this, every city in the UK and across Scotland will have the same question. So we can take this anywhere and saying is, okay, how can we work with our retrofitters? How can we work with our energy providers? Just saying is, what are the ones we focus on? What are the priorities and how do we make this work? So I hope you'll hear more about it as we develop it. Step one of us is to make sure we map it.
Okay. No, that's really helpful. My final question is a broader question around community engagement, and it seems maybe a little bit odd to ask this panel that, but I think it is important. What role do you think community voice should have in your planning and your work? And because I think we've seen, when we talk about Just Transition, we tend to focus on commercial activity and to a lesser extent on workers and the skills needed, and we forget that
all of those people live in communities. Communities are directly and indirectly affected by not only the economy, but the other things that, that happen as a consequence of our energy economy. Where do you see the weaknesses in what we are doing as far as the sort of broader just bit around community engagement and hearing community voice? I don't know which of you wants to take that first. Go on, Gordon. Thanks.
For us... I should start by saying it's normally been Alison Carrington from our regional team that was here today, and Alison's got pretty deep engagement into different community groups and through community planning partnerships and that type of activity. Okay. If I think about communities that have been involved in before to address this type of thing, then it would probably be connecting through the trade union movements, and because in terms of employees and engaging there, so that would be where I would engage. Personally, I'm involved from Ayrshire originally. I chair a community development trust, and we've just completed the financial deal in a 3-megawatt wind turbine, right? But it's been an uphill battle. Educating, we've got renewable bikes, electric bikes, car hire scheme, electric van. But it's an uphill struggle, actually, then bringing the local community in. You need to work really hard in that whole kind of process of engagement. And we've been doing that for 20 years, so but you know, you get really good wins, maybe small wins, but you get really good wins, and particularly much more around the whole kind of wellbeing agenda. So again, going back to the kind of Just Transition Commission, that was one of their kind of calls. Yeah. It would move away from just thinking about GDP and thinking more about wellbeing and measuring through the National Performance Framework, that type of thing. But,
Thanks, Gordon. That's helpful. Suzanne, we've just had a brief discussion about the role of SMEs, and I'm wondering if there's a micro enterprise bit that we're missing that actually is much more community located and community situated in a way. That is there stuff in that we're missing, that very local positive impact, but very, very small?
We would look at that in the context of individual projects,
right.
Especially
okay.
if we were funding them. But if we were active at all, we would look at the impact in the local community in that context.
Okay.
As most of our drive is, of course, towards net zero, and any project that we're funding would take into account, obviously, Fair Work and net zero and all of that. It's kind of a matter, of course, for it to be taken into account. So I would say that it would be on a project-by-project basis, really, in that scenario.
OK, thanks. And Paul, do you
Very
have any?
Quickly, I was involved in the Climate Assembly last year, which was done as part of the big effort for how do we get Scotland to zero. We got literally 100 people involved from all across Scotland to actually just have a discussion with experts about what we need to do. I thought it was incredibly powerful to get the different voices in to actually set us up for success. There was so much to learn from what people say. There's such an unknown and scary factor around, we're going to give you an electric vehicle, you need to change your heating system, you can't travel anymore. It really is. We don't make it attractive for people, we make it actually quite scary. And so I saw the power of actually seeing that, and I think actually we need to do that on steroids across the country, you know, really, again, help people with the change, explain it to them and say what is it, and the community voice in this whole conversation is key. It is so easy to talk about a wind farm or hydrogen plant or carbon capture storage facility, and it sounds all very scary when it's on your doorstep. We're going to have to make it real to see how it fits in the plan, what it means for them, what the implications are, what choices we really have. And I thought the whole climate assembly conversation, maybe should be done by region or maybe by whatever mechanism, it just changed my mindset around how to have conversations.
That's really helpful. Thank you. I'll leave it there, Claire.
Thank you. If I just ask a couple of quick questions. Suzanne, if I come to you, the supply chain development statements in the ScotWind leasing round, can I ask, do you think they've been delivered on, and are they sufficient to support the supply chain? I don't know if you're able to give us an insight on that.
Yes, so about 28 point something billion, I think, was committed through the supply chain development statements. And then there's been more commitments through INTOG and others. So it's a very big sum of money. I'd say it's too early to say if they're being delivered on. The hope is that through... it's seen internationally as been quite innovative that we have these supply chain development statements. So I think it's widely recognised as a very helpful step forward and something we'd want to build on. But it's not really a time to play through as to what actually happens in the market. The starting point is the large scale ports, harbours, big large scale manufacturing. And the SIM process has been the vehicle through which these are being looked at. And as I said earlier, there are 44 projects. And just earlier this week, the detailed project outlines have started to be published, and the developers will then be sitting down to look at them. And our expectation is that might lead to a package of support mm-hmm. that might go into some of these projects that would include the developers and might include more than one developer. So I think the proof of that will be in what happens in the coming months to see if that plays through mm-hmm. to actual spend.
That's helpful, thank you. And if I just come to Gordon, we are expecting an updated climate emergency skills action plan by the end of the year. Can you tell us anything? Well, can you let us know if that is still the timescale and what we can expect when we be in it?
So our government, our sponsor division, had indicated earlier in the year that they would take ownership of the next iteration of the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan. When I was speaking to the team just in preparation for the committee, I think you said that you've written to Mr. Gray as part of your pre-budget scrutiny and asked for an update on CSAP. So still their intention, I think, to produce something in December. So I'll leave it at that. In terms of the work we've done, at the mid-year point of the initial five-year plan, we've done an evaluation of all our activity, and that's available in terms of both the evidence piece and then some of the initial pilot work that we've done both in Shetland and Glasgow. So I could share that with the committee if that's of interest.
Yeah, because I was going to raise that in your briefing for the committee, it said that SDS and partners have developed a good understanding of the emerging picture. It references the Emergency Skills Action Plan, regional skills assessments, but it doesn't specify what that is. But it says, you know, you've got good understanding of the emerging picture, but doesn't state what it is.
I'll come back. So there's several reports that we can share with you that exact summaries and then the detailed analysis, which also breaks down what's considered as a green job. And we're looking at a way of using a kind of green SOC code, but there's more work to be done in that. So it's a way to try and analyse the number of jobs that will be influenced by the progression to net zero, but I can send more to the committee.
If you could do, has been a recurring theme, I think, this morning, that we recognise there's skills gaps, but nobody's exactly clear where they are or how many people we need or how we're going to get to the end point. So if you've got information that could help with that, that would be appreciated.
I referenced some of the work that we're just doing just now based on the SOWIC data that we've got, which takes into account some of the developers' plans, so that's kind of slightly longer term. So I think I'll package up what we have mm-hmm. and then give you an indication of what's still in.
And would it be the intention, because another theme this morning was the lack of data, so it's difficult for us to see what progress we're making on a just transition because we don't have enough information to judge that. Will the information that SDS is working on help with developing a framework in which to judge progress?
That would be the intention. And again, we'll go back to the Just Transition Commission and look at the kind of work that they've done around some of the kind of sectoral strategies, because they've produced publications now looking at the sector plans in areas like construction, for example. So I think there's additional work that can be done there.
OK, thank you. Thank you very much to the panel for their evidence this morning, and I'll now move into private session.